Hello and welcome back to round two, this time of the Women's Candidates. I'm your host, International Master Jovanka Hauska, and I'm absolutely thrilled to be calling all the action back alongside the one and only International Master, Casa Corley. And after yesterday's intense start, what do you think? Do you think we're going to see more of the same?
It's so great to be back with you again, Jovi. The games yesterday were awesome. We got really good fighting chess and one decisive result. And I think now that the first round jitters are behind us, we're going to see even more interesting chess today.
Yeah, you mentioned it there, first round jitters. And I think that's primarily because this is a brand new format. It's never been seen in the Candidates before. And let's check it out. It's a double round robin tournament. The players have all earned their spot via different qualification methods. And of course, remember, this is a winner takes it all, because the winner earns the right to challenge four-time women's world champion Ju Wenjun later on in the year in a match. And of course, there is a lot of money at stake, 250,000 euros total prize pool. So lots of things to play for.
Yeah, and though that prize fund is going to be distributed across many players, really this is one of the rare tournaments, the candidates, where first place is the only place that really matters, because only one person gets to challenge Ju Wenjun for the world championship. So keep that in mind as we progress through these 14 rounds. Also, the time control, a little bit different. It's 90 minutes for the first 40 moves and 30 minutes of bonus time after that, with 30-second increment from move one. So the pace is relatively quick. The women voted on this time control, so we may get some time scrambles as we did yesterday.
Yeah, we certainly had a lot of intense action on the board yesterday. As you mentioned, checkmates, time scrambles, and let's have a look at today's pairings, because I suspect we might be in for the same. Katerina Lagno plays old rival Humpy Kanaru. Tan Zhongyi faces Vaishali. Nurgul Salimova, Leighton Jay, and Alexandra Goreshkina plays against Anna Muzichuk. Anything that takes your fancy, Casa?
Yeah, Tan Zhongyi was so impressive yesterday with the black pieces. I'm really curious to see how she plays against Vaishali, who is a very, very talented player in her own right and navigated her time trouble really well yesterday. Other matchup that draws the eye is Alexandra Goreshkina versus Anna Muzichuk. That should be another really interesting game.
Yeah, I'm also excited to see Leighton Jay, whether she'll get a comeback win. And for you at home, it's your chances to win prizes by voting on who is going to win before every round by going to each game on the FIDE Candidates and FIDE Women's Candidates events pages. Find the social tab and pick your winner. go.chess.com/candidatesvotes, and you only have a couple of minutes before the games begin, so get voting now. Prizes to be won. Yeah, this is going to be epic today. I have a feeling in my bones that we're going to see fire on the board, Casa.
Yeah, I mean, basically yesterday that we had a few compatriot matchups, right? We had an all-India affair. We also had an all-China affair. Today, very different story. We have a FIDE flag versus Ukrainian flag. That should be interesting. We have, you know, China, India. We have, another Russian versus India. So all very, very different scene today. And it's, you know, you see in front of you, you can see these, they're about to get underway. We'll maybe potentially see some handshakes and some very interesting dynamics just ahead of us.
Yeah. And there you can see the youngest competitor, Nurgul Salimova, facing off against Leighton Jay. Leighton Jay being the recipient of a devastating loss against her friend Tan Zhongyi. Nurgul Salimova, she's the most underrated by far. She's the lowest seed. And moving on, you can see former women's world champion Tan Zhongyi, the only player to win yesterday against Vaishali. Now, these two look like they're quite calm, but they have ferocious styles. They absolutely thrive in chaotic, complex positions. So I cannot wait to see what's going to be happening here. The last time they played, there was a spectacular win for Vaishali.
Yeah, again, very, very interesting chess. I feel like Tan Zhongyi would likely play a queen's pawn opening, something like d4. And we have a game underway. So we see the first removes there. I'm not sure there was a handshake there, but we are underway, and we have a d4, d5 on the board. So let's jump right in and see where that goes.
Let's absolutely, because the first question has already been answered. Gureshkina, she started off with a double white. Yesterday, she played e4. Today, it is d4. And Anu Musichuk playing the Slav defense. It's not necessarily an opening I associate with her.
Yeah, a bit of a surprise. It also invites Gureshkina to, you know, play an exchange. I'd be shocked if that actually happens, but it is on the cards. White is a little bit better usually with a bit of a space advantage with the pawn c4 versus the pawn c6, but we'll see.
I spoke too soon.
An exchange. Yeah. Maybe there is, well, I must say there are a lot of devoted exchange Slav players that will argue that the tempo is really, the extra tempo in a symmetrical position means a lot. And usually there's a way to tell whether white, if white is really playing for something. It's if the white knight goes to c3 and the bishop goes to f4 very quickly, and white delays the knight on g1, usually bring it to e2 instead. If the knights come to f3 and c3 and it's completely symmetrical in that way, usually it's a sign that you're going to kind of steer it towards equality. And yeah, bishop f4 is the kind of aggressive way. So we'll see if it's really about where this knight on g1 goes. If the knight goes to e2, we're going to have a real full-throated fight. If it goes to F3, it's a bit more tepid.
Yeah, I mean, there are lots of interesting lines here, because I remember that that has been recommended for people to play F3 and E4, but that involves a very quick knight C3. I've also had experience myself with going knight C3 and rook C1. That's also a very tricky line. It's not as equal as it appears. It looks like it's completely symmetrical, but because white does have that liberty of that first move, then there are chances to create an imbalance. But I have the caveat here. You need to play in a very energetic way. If you just play routinely with knight c3, knight to f3, as you mentioned, e3, la 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 la, then you're not going to cause any trouble whatsoever to black's position. And e3 on the board.
Yeah, and it's also important to point out that you could have started with knight c3 instead of bishop f4 on move 4 for white, but there is a gambit after knight c3 that black can play e5, and it's not the best move in the world, but it is an option, and so you can argue that bishop f4 is even more precise because it just cuts out this gambit option entirely, it's a clever move order, if you will.
I never knew about that one, so thank you. I will introduce that one into my arsenal. Okay, so bishop f4, knight c6, e3, knight to f6, and now I'm expecting knight c3.
Totally agree. That's the typical course. And really, black here has a few options. So one of the ways, there are really two ways that are most common. There may be like half a dozen ways, but the two ways that are most common are playing bishop g4 here. Okay, we have knight c3 on the board. So bishop g4 would be the one way to kind of get the bishop outside of the pawn chain before you you insist on playing e6. It's just so your bishop is out, just like white's bishop is out, white's queenside bishop. The alternative is actually just to play a6. And this is also quite popular as well. A6 is a bit of a useful prophylactic waiting move, covering the b5 squares so that there's no knight c7 funny business. And in many lines, it just serves a decent purpose to cover that square.
Yeah, she's gone for the bishop f5 line. Yeah, a6 has a nice idea, a nice trick behind it that, maybe I'll just show it. So after knight c3, instead of bishop f5, if you were to go a6, and say white were to go queen to b3, I'm pretty sure at times you can just develop the bishop out. You can put your bishop out to f5 because after, and it has to be done with e6. It has to be done a little bit later. So I go knight to f3, and say now I go a6. The queen comes to b3. Now you can just go e6. Right? And the queen is trapped right after queen takes b7.
It's a little bit tricky in here because I think there's queen c7 in some lines and the bishop supports it.
Yeah.
But this theme that you're mentioning is so common in many Sicilians and many different openings where that knight a5 typically does trap the queen in different lines because all of the squares on the b file, as you're pointing out, are covered, all the retreating squares, right? The queen would cover b6, the pawn would cover b5. So it's actually pretty close to this. Bishop f5 actually is the move that Muzychuk actually played. Is actually the most popular line. I neglected that. There are three real lines. The way you test this one is you test it with queen b3. And what happens is there's this little dance that happens where queen b3 hits the b7 pawn, as you were pointing out. Knight a5 happens to defend the b7 pawn. And then you go queen a4 check. And then the bishop blocks on d7. And then you go queen c2 back. And this little dance, this little skirmish that happened, essentially, there are two pieces that are a little bit misplaced, you could say. Primarily, it's the bishop on d7, but it's also that knight on a5, as you're pointing out. And a lot of times, black now, not having gotten to losing control of the f5 square, basically cedes that the bishop is going to be locked in the chain with e6 and accepts this position. The upside, if there is upside here, I would say, is that the black rook is going to bear down on that queen on c2 from c8 in the future. And there's some sharp tensions, dynamics connected to that. So, yeah.
It's a nice idea that White has. And these are the kind of ideas that are a little bit ambitious for White because White does have this bishop out there on f4. But one thing I've got to say about this type of position is because there's no tension in the center, play transforms over to the wing. And a way that black will often counter this is even if white just puts a knight on c5, you can just take it and then just expand as much as you can with your pawns because the play is quite stable. And that's when the computers and the grandmasters of yore used to say that is the moment to expand on the flanks. So
Well
I do
said.
see a few more moves, and the bishop comes to f5, knight to f3, e6, and now maybe bishop comes out to b5. I've seen that one played. I've also seen queen to b3 as well.
So it must be said, the knight coming to f3, not going for the queen b3 line, is the absolute most symmetrical version of this position. And so it's really quite calm. And wow, okay, knight e5 is different. That I was gonna say, typically you have a series of exchanges now, bishop d3, bishop takes d3, queen takes d3, bishop d6, and so on, and then it re actually usually fizzles out. Maybe this knight e5 is an additional wrinkle that Goretzka has explored, because this one is again moving a piece twice in the opening, giving black time. I think in the best circumstance, white can argue that if I take on c6 and that c pawn becomes backward for an extended period of time, maybe I could play bully ball on it with like some, rook c1, knight a4 dynamic later. But we're a ways from that. So, but this one, I will say the character of this position will not change for a minute. And so we probably could pop over somewhere else. And I'm actually noticing some very interesting structures elsewhere in the bird's eye. So yeah, I'll give it to you, Jovi. Where do you
Okay,
want to
let's
take
take
us?
it to the bird's eye first. Okay, so I'm drawn to. Well, the game that I really wanted to have a look at was between Tan Zhongyi and Vaishali.
Okay.
I'm really keen to follow that game because both those players have that exciting, chaotic style. Let me just get it up. And how did this one start? Let's go to the beginning. And here we see d4 again, Tan Zhongyi. She's been experimenting, with e4, d4, c4. And here is the first answer. It is d4, knight f6. And knight c3. So now
Yeah.
you have to accept that a pawn will come to d5, and now bishop to f4.
And we affectionately call this the Jobava London. From where I sit, I usually this is how I think about it. And it's a very interesting structure because, when you're younger, you essentially learn by experience or maybe because someone tells you that, you know, putting a knight in front of a C pawn and queen's pawn openings isn't so sensible, because usually the open or semi-open files tend to be on the C and D lines and these structures, and the pawn C2 would love to be involved. The niche with this, and you know, this is modern chess, if you will, is that that knight sometimes threatens this knight B5 fork, supported by the bishop on F4, almost like that exchange Slav we were just looking at. And because of it, you know, sometimes black has to waste a tempo with A6 to cover or to just worry about that. And that headache sometimes forces a few concessions from black. C5 is very sharp and principled. Knight B5 right now does not make sense because queen A5 check. And yeah, not usually white files with E3.
Queen A5, yeah. Queen A5 check is going to be, well, unfortunate to say the least for white. So yeah, you don't want that. So instead of that, let's just go to the game. And instead of C5, E3 played, C takes D4, E takes D4. And to me, this almost feels like an exchange caro. Can't, except you've gone knight C3.
You know what else it's kind of like?
Which isn't the best.
No, but you know what's funny? You know what's funny, though? You know what's funny about the exchange caro con? An exchange caro con structure is what, right? Because we talked about it yesterday. It's a Carlsbad.
And it so is a Carlsbad.
It's a Carlsbad structure. And it a lot of times, if you're a Jabava London player or you're a London player, period, you might like the Carlsbad structure. So it's interesting. Tan Zhongyi had tremendous success in the Carlsbad yesterday. And she's a basically getting a position that is somewhat analogous, except I must confess that in the medium term, the knight on c3 will be misplaced. And I think Vaishali does something very sensible here by playing a6, essentially cutting this knight on c3 so that it has no jumping squares forward, and it will have to be redeployed at some juncture.
Yeah. I'm not sure about this move, A6. I feel it's a little bit unnecessary. In my course, I coin a name for this poor, unfortunate bishop on C8. I call it the bully. And in this type of structure, you want to put it out on G4. And if you don't get it to G4, you've got to get it out to F5. And the whole reason I call it a bully is because literally it just wants to be flexing away. It wants to be attacking the queen. It wants to be threatening a knight on F3. It wants to trade itself off for this piece. It doesn't matter. It wants to be targeting something. So I feel like A6 perhaps is okay. I'm not going to criticize that move too much because it does control this knight moving to B5. But I'm not quite sure how necessary it was. But okay, A6, knight to F3. And now here I feel like knight C6 maybe might. Mm-hmm. It's okay. It's okay. I'm not, again, not going to criticize it. But I do wonder whether you can go bishop G4 and just get rid of this piece.
Because well, I'll tell you what. If bishop G4 happened, typically white would go for H3 to secure that bishop pair. And normally as a caro player, you're thrilled to get the bishop outside the chain, exchange, you have no bad pieces. But I'll tell you what, in many of these structures, white can castle queenside and go g4 and really start to play g5, h4. And in some positions, yeah, actually, you play like g4, you'll castle long. Many of these positions, at some point, the rook on h1 will go to h3 to defend laterally white's queen side and so it will serve as a useful attacker and defender, and it gets very sharp very quickly. And so I've seen some engine games like this that, you know, it seems like black has solved all their problems, but it's not so clear.
It's not so clear. Okay, that's good to know, because I was feeling, hang on a second, what is this knight doing here? But okay, let's go back to the game. And after, I like your idea, by the way, h3, g4. And if this is what we're going to get with the Jabova London system, maybe I'm going to head that knight c6. And now h3, stopping this bishop coming out to g4. So now I'm like, okay, the caro player in me goes, get that bishop out, put it on f5. And is there anything here with ideas of jumping in with your knight to e5 and then push on the king side?
So I'll tell you, this is actually a very decent version of it's basically a Carlsbad with a knight on c3 that's ultimately going to be misplaced. So I think, mm-hmm, if the bishop does come to f5, you will ultimately see bishop d3 to exchange it because it's just too impactful there. And you're going to also see something like knight e2 or knight b1 or maybe even knight a4. Like the problem is the knight on c3, you'd much rather have the pawn there. And as you mentioned yesterday, that Carlsbad knight loves to be on d6 or conversely d3 in the structure. And so I think the thing is Tan Zhongyi got the structure she wanted. She showed great success with it yesterday. But the question is she going to be able to have the same piece play that she also got yesterday? Keep in mind, she had an awesome kingside attack yesterday. The queen was on h4, which would be conversely h5 here. It's a bit of a different story. So that the pieces are the issue here.
Yeah, definitely. I agree with you. This knight on c3 makes an odd impression. And I just wanted to highlight one way that if you're playing against a piece that's in front of its own pawns, the way that you fight against it is primarily you just put your rook on the open line. You make sure that this knight can't move. So that means you stage one, attack this pawn on c2. And then after you've done that, you prevent the knight from moving, then you start destabilizing it. So then you turn your attention to b2, the defenders of c3. And once you've done that, provoked a weakness, then you go back to the original weakness on c2.
Yeah. So again, this position two will actually probably not change its character for a minute, just kind of like the exchange Slav. So we're going to have to let things simmer here for a moment. But I think thus far, at least, you know, one of the things about the London structures, and this is a London adjacent position being the Jabava London, it's very strategic. It's not a move by move dynamic as much as understanding of the structure and the position. And you can see Vaishali really taking her time here. Ding Liren showed excellent understanding in the London structures in his World Championship match last year. So maybe there's something to the Chinese players maybe understanding this pretty well and going for it. Who knows? But we'll see. We'll see how this game develops.
I'm really actually quite fascinated with both of the games that we've seen because Vaishali plays the London system. She doesn't often play d4, but when she does, she plays the Jabava London. And now she's having her opening played against her. And the same with Anna Muzychuk. Anna Muzychuk is playing the Slav, which is something that Gary Ashkina is an expert in. So it's like some kind of mind games going on between everyone. So this is one of the things I love about this type of competition. Everybody knows that they're here with seconds. They are armed to the teeth with opening novelties, ideas to make the other uncomfortable. We've seen some people being very open about who their seconds are. Others, like Humpy, have said no, they'd rather not disclose who they are, and they will release the information if they do well. So we'll find out in due course. So let's go back to the bird's eye view. I agree with you. The pawn structure is pretty stable. So let's have a look at some of the other games. So I chose last time. Perhaps you can choose this time.
So I feel like we should maybe take a gander at the Humpy Lucknow game because we have a position that was seen several times in the World Championship match between Magnus and Nepo a little while back. This closed Ruy Lopez position was debated ad nauseum, really, and I'm curious to, you know, see what the latest developments are because I'm not updated in the past year or so since that it was debated in that match. Essentially, usually in these structures, black is like a very slightly worse. It's the point is that there's some pressure, this pawn tension. I like to call it a positive pawn tension when I think of pawn tensions as negative and positive. And so when your pawn is in contact with the enemy pawn, it's a tension. And at any point you can release it. And here white can, I call this a positive pawn tension for white because white could take on b5 at any moment. And it's something that that's hanging over black's head every single move. Whereas black, you don't really want to release it with b takes a4 because then the A pawn would be really weak and wouldn't be supported by the rest of the chain. So it's something that Black usually just has to, you know, toe the line with. You can play B4 and release that way without weakening your A6 pawn. But a lot of times White will actually go A5 and cut the B pawn from the A pawn so that the A pawn becomes a weakness deep into the end game. And then the C4 square is even a little sensitive. So a knight from B1 could hop in D2 to C4 and kind of massage that area. So usually that's just a tension that's maintained, and Black has to make some other useful moves. Usually it's something along the lines of, as we mentioned yesterday, rook e8, bishop f8, h6 to stop knight g5, d6, yes. And you're just slightly worse, and you just have to deal with that. I think it's a position Humpy, it's kind of in her wheelhouse. Like, she's a solid defending player, and Lochnow is a theoretician, so who knows?
Yeah, who knows? And remember, Humpy did start the tournament with a double black. And when you have that fortune bestowed on you, I guess you want to be playing solid. But when it comes to a position like this that's so heavily analyzed, and everyone and anyone has looked at it with machines, and I'll be honest here, everybody has access to those machines. It's just to go online and pay some money and have some virtual cloud, some very strong engine there analyzing on the cloud, and you kind of get to understand every single wrinkle and nuance in the position. How can one actually play such a position and try or even hope to get an advantage?
So it's actually a great question. It's something that all, you know, top players and even players below the top are worried about. It's how do you create something original, because there's a fine line between objectivity, which is the actual truth of the position, and practicality, which is in a one-off scenario, getting the most out of that game. And I think a lot of it is kind of balancing your own strengths. You know, if you're someone that is a talented attacker, you know, playing to that strength or playing to your opponent's weakness. And I will tell you, there's some ideas here that might not be objectively correct, but are very interesting. One I have seen before, I'll just mention two for White. Sometimes they actually don't touch the knight on B1 for a minute, and they go bishop D2. And the idea is to manually stop this knight A5 move in a really unique way. The bishop on D2 looks ridiculous, but it is something I have seen to kind of like thwart the knight A5 plan, because sometimes you can even sack the E5 pawn martial style and take the bishop pair by capturing on B3 and then playing D5 and saying, okay, I have this really active, you know, situation. So that's one idea. Another idea actually is you put a black pawn on H6, but I have seen some configuration with where the knight comes to G5, black plays H, so let's say rook E8, let's say, or
okay,
D6.
Okay. Yeah. Rook E8.
So
okay,
knight D6, G5. Yeah,
D6, knight G5.
And let's say like H6. It's actually probably more impactful with the rook on E8, but we'll let this slide. I've seen ideas with F4 and H4. And the idea, again, it's not correct as correct here with the rook on E1, but the point is there's ideas of sacking your knight, recapturing with the pawn on G5, and then going G6 if the knight moves, and then bringing the queen into H5 to threaten mate. Now, this is obviously way more impactful if the rook is on E8. So that's why I was saying, like, if black goes for this rook E8, bishop F8 plan and doesn't play H6, you can sometimes get these, I almost want to call them like a Simon Williams style attack out of nowhere, right? So that's also a thing. So there's ways you can play it positionally and tactically, and it really just comes down to your style.
Yeah. Okay. It certainly is a question of style, you know. Well, one of these things about, okay, so rook E8, actually, we have an answer. Rook E8 played, inviting white to go knight to G5, and then this rook will just slide back to F8, and then H6 will come. But just about question of style, it's nice to see that there are particular situations where you can play very ambitiously, sacrificing a knight, because I associate these positions with very small advantage, almost minute, you know, completely invisible, because sometimes it will just hinge on the fact that this bishop on b3 is better than its counterpart on b7, which is just eyeballing a wall. Whereas white also has access to the square on d5. That may or may not be a plan that white does at a later stage of the game, but it's all very small and black ultimately is rock solid. And as you mentioned, we did see Magnus Carlsen. He was very happy to curl into a ball against Jan Opomniachtchi and just hold the draw, do what the position demanded. A takes b5 played. The rooks are going to come off the board.
And this happens a lot. It's funny because Nepo tried this with white several times against Magnus, and Magnus defended admirably every single time. I've seen Nepo have great success with this line too, though. And in particular, I can recall a game, I think it was at the World Rapid just this past year, where he had the white pieces in one of the early rounds. Someone in the chat can maybe check this. But in one of the early rounds of the World Rapid, he played the same system he'd been trying to, you know, grind down Magnus in, and it was a similar position where the rooks on 8 were traded, and he wound up winning the game and used almost no time because he was basically using World Championship prep. And so there's still venom here, even though there's some trades, and a lot of it hinges on this kingside play deep into the end game. So again, knight g5 is still potentially a thing. There's also some ideas of h3 and knight h2, knight g4, like we saw yesterday. There's ideas of bishop g5 takes f6 sometimes. There's all types of trickiness that will basically be, you know, Humpy will have to defend for a little while and ideally trade some more pieces, because that's usually how you extinguish the slight pull that white has.
Yeah, that it's to do with this bishop on b7. It just doesn't have a role. But then, and also I think you'll, and Humpy is excellent at this, you also have to abandon ambitious tries, because often, as you mentioned yesterday, the human mind wants to be doing something. It wants to be breaking out with d5. There's just no way that black will ever get anything like that. Instead, just black has to just focus on keeping it solid. I kind of call this chess the Gandalf style, thou shalt not pass.
Ah, I love that. Yeah. I love that. I've not heard that before. I love
that. Oh, yeah. No, the Scottish team at an Olympiad, they told me this. Oh, she played like Gandalf. And I was like, oh, hello. That implies some aggression.
Yeah, that...
And they said, no, thou shalt not pass. And I was like, ah, okay, I'm stealing that.
It's always important too. Like, it's like, is this a compliment or like, what's the deal? Like, let me know. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, it's funny. This position won't change materially for a little bit. So we could probably, take us a moment and look and go back to the bird's eyes we are now. And maybe we check in on the game we haven't looked at all. We haven't checked out, Salimova Li Tingjie yet. And maybe we will take a gander over there.
Yes. Well, we can see something immediately. The queens are off. And maybe we have a look at how this occurred. Starting from the beginning, it was a queen's gambit accepted d4, d5, c4, d takes c4. And Lei, remember, losing yesterday with the white pieces against her compatriot Tan Zhongyi. That must have been very, very hard to lose with the white pieces first round. It's not going to be easy. E3, E6, now she has the black pieces against the lowest seed, the youngest participant, that almost like feels like the wild card. Nurgul Salimova getting here because she finished second in the World Cup. And now bishop takes pawn. Now, one thing that I realized about Lei in my Women's World Championship commentary is that her favorite pawn break of the board is always c5. Wherever she can, she doesn't care about structure, she gets in c5. And sure enough, it appears quite early on. And after castles, a6, b3, and now c takes d4, and here white just goes queen takes d4. That's unusual, because I was expecting knight takes d4. You know, keep the queens on.
Yeah, so there's some interesting nuances here. And I, even before getting into the position, I want to ask you, because Lei lost yesterday. It was obviously a tough game, as you mentioned. some people ascribe to this notion that if I lose a game in the very next one, I'm just going to kind of batter the hatches, not even be that ambitious or anything. And just the priority will be not losing another one. I don't know if this was like a Russian school thing, but it was like, lose, then you draw the next day, you know?
Yep.
Is that the approach that you think is the, what you would have, or, and conversely, do you think it's the right approach? Because this, it's clear from the opening choice, when you play Queen's Gambit accepted at this level, it's not one that's going to give you winning chances typically. So I would say a game positions like this, they're relatively symmetrical. A lot of times white has a little bit ahead, like almost like an exchange slav in a way. And I would say the chances are like 10% win for black, 50-60% yeah. draw, and then like 30% win for white. Are you comfortable with those odds?
Yes, primarily because I only have one style of play. So I can't just go, you know what, today I'm going to play the King's Indian. That doesn't work in my book because I only played like the Queen's Gambit declined or the semi-slav. So I kind of have to just accept what is coming my way. When it comes to your mindset, I do believe that's really individual. It depends on the person. You know, we've seen players in the past, like Magnus, he's able to bounce back. He doesn't subscribe to this, oh no, play solidly. He just goes and does his stuff and he bounces back even after 2-3 losses in a row. Other people, you know, it might have shaken her confidence, and you just might need just to take it easy for one game and then just kind of feel that connection to the pieces and then get back into the tournament. Remember, this is still very, very early days. So yeah, okay, a first round loss isn't ideal, but then again, it's not the end of the world. And something that I always tell my students, you know, when they get a boring position and they've equalized with the black pieces, I say, well, you know, you still have a job to do. You know, stage one is equalized, well done, you've done that, and then just keep on playing and see what you can make out of it. So I should live by the rules that I preach.
Fair enough. So all right, let's get into actually talking about this position. We're a few moves behind, but basically queen takes d4, knight takes d4, b5 happened,
b5 played, which is an interesting b2. Yeah, I'm never sure about b5 because b5 could be that proverbial hook, because white does have in the back of the pocket moves like a4, and the reason why this can be quite dangerous, and I know lots of people might be going, dangerous, what do you mean dangerous, the queen, there's no queens on the board, everything looks boring, but because you're challenging this pawn will force to step up to b4 and you concede the c4 square. And then when you compare the minor pieces and you compare who has access to the open lines, white's going to be very quick with putting a rook to d1, perhaps a rook to c1. And this can be quite unpleasant for black to handle. I've seen a lot of grandmasters lose this type of endgame. So knight takes d4, b5, bishop e2, nice move, bishop b7, and now bishop to b2, knight d7, and knight to d2. Yeah. I'm not gonna lie, I kind of like white's position a little bit, just on account of the fact that it's gonna be very quick with the rooks to go to d1. You have a4 constantly for black to worry about. And
agreed.
And you know, one, if you've kind of failed to do anything on the center, then you can just work your magic, expand as much as you can on the king side. This bishop on b2 is a sleeping giant. It doesn't look like it's doing much, but you mark my words, it can become powerful at the right moment and if given the opportunity.
Yeah, no question about it. I think another thing to point out that's important is that I see it all the time. White players mishandle the Queen's Gambit accepted. And there is maybe one tiny problem I don't like about white's position, but basically it's been handled relatively well. So note that this knight on d2, the Queen's Knight went to d2 instead of c3. And you see in so many positions, weaker players put the knight on c3 very quickly and these Queen's Gambit accepted positions. And the problem is when the expansion actually happens, the knight on c3 is dominated. It can't jump to e4. it, the b5 pawn restricts it, the e6 pawn restricts it. And so it's very, very savvy to put the knight on d2 instead of c3 because it has more scope from there. Conversely, a lot of times when you do see b5, I've seen so many players put the bishop on d3 instead of e2. And it's always better on e2, even if the queens were on the board. If there's a queen on d1 and d8, it's always better on e2 because you have this idea of going bishop f3 in some positions, and you just don't interrupt the rooks or the heavy pieces from engaging on the c and d lines. And so the one problem with white's position that I really don't like is this knight on d4. The knight on d4 is not well placed, frankly. It obstructs the bishop on b2. It also doesn't have any squares to really seize on. And, you know,
if you mentioned,
mentioned the a4 thing. You mentioned the a4 thing. If you get an a4, the knight can come to c4 and support another knight coming to e5.
This is one of those things where it's quite double-edged with this knight on d4. It looks good. It's an octo knight, but like you say, it doesn't have too many squares, only c6, and maybe. But on the other hand, it can't really be chased away either, because if black ever goes e5, then knight comes to f5. And suddenly, look who's talking. But yeah, it's definitely, there's some onus now on black and white to come up with some accurate plans. Like, I loved your idea of going bishop to f3, primarily also because this knight on d4 gets access to c6. And if black is not very careful, then maybe a rook can come to c1, and maybe there can be some infiltration happening there on the c line. So definitely something to worry about. And plus, I'm still a big fan of my it's not even my idea. I've seen it before many times, but the suggestion a4, big fan of that. So if black does a move like bishop to e7, bishop to d6, then I would be tempted to go a4, start destabilizing the queen side right now.
And yeah, and you were actually with the bishop on e7. I mean, I'm also really tempted to go to put a rook on c1 because knight c6 will be a tempo on the bishop on e7. So I feel like the bishop has to go somewhere else. Like, I feel like it either d6 or b4. You will see in some positions the dark square bishop actually trade itself for a knight, and it will mean again that black is slightly worse. But you hope that if the b and a pawns come off the board and it's basically one side of the board is vacuumed, that essentially the bishop pair won't be a decisive pressing advantage.
Yes. Well, interesting moment, right? There's some danger underneath because I agree with you. Probably this bishop has to come out to b4. Put some pressure on d2, but then again, what's it doing? So, and Leiting J, she's had a pause now. And if you look at the clock times as well, you can see that Lei has a lot less time on the clock. So she has been caught unawares here.
Yeah, it's decision time for sure. Definitely decision time. So, oh, and bishop b4 has been played.
Of course. She's an active player. That's one of the things that I love about her style. She's activity over everything. She gives up a pawn in order to get her pieces mobile. And she's really dangerous. What can I say?
Yeah. Man, so we'll let this simmer for a minute. The knight on d2 is now under fire, and white has to deal with that threat. So figure out what to do with that knight.
Yep. And now that we've seen all the players emerge from the opening, I think it's the perfect time for us to head towards a break. But we have some exciting things in stock for you, because you can stock up on chess merch at the chess.com shop. We've got you covered with fresh new t-shirt designs, mittens, plushies, and accessories. So head to go.chess.com/merch or use exclam merch in chat to shop now before it's all sold out. And on that note, we are going to go on a quick break, so don't go anywhere.
Everyone loves playing chess, and everyone loves Chess Club. But there's also a time and a place for playing all your favorite games.
Hey, we're trying to have a lesson here. You need to get out of here.
Recently, more kids have been playing chess than ever in school. But sadly, we've learned that they may not always be playing chess at the most appropriate time.
Eh ben, classe, aujourd'hui...
While it might be sometimes okay to grab a game between classes, or if your teacher gives you permission and hasn't given you an assignment, it's not okay to be playing chess in school when you aren't supposed to. And chess should never come between you taking your studies seriously and cooperating with your fellow students and teachers. Chess over the board or on the phone is a great way to spend time with friends. But let's make sure that this school year, we don't let too much chess happen in the classroom. Focus on your school, because chess.com will always be there when class is over.
Chess is cool! Respect your school!
All right, that was awesome, everybody. Great job.
Look what I did.
Danny, did you spell that?
Yeah.
Can we get some other letters, please?
What's wrong with it?
And we are back for our coverage of round two. The players have completed their openings, and today it seems like everyone got the memo that it's all about a stable pawn structure, just playing in a very positional manner. Because if we take a look at the bird's eye view, we can see there's not that much drama happening. which game catches your eye?
Yeah, and most of the structures are pretty typical. I think the thing that's really unique, though, is the game we kind of started with was Muzychuk versus Gretchkina, Gretchkina's white. Because there's a really weird looking pawn structure, and I think that, I think black is going to get the bishop pair, but it turns out that, you know, white is going to have something to say about that too. So if we go forward, a few more moves, we can see what happened.
Yeah, so we left it at knight to e5, and now we can see that Mana Muzychuk went knight takes knight, pawn takes knight, and now knight to d7. And this was the big idea, e4. And after d takes e4, bishop comes out to b5, now pinning and winning, as we like to say. Although you've got to be careful, it's just a guideline. And then a6, bishop takes knight, queen takes, and then now the queens have come off. And what do we think about this? Because the first thing is you can see knight a4 is a potential idea of going knight to b6. That's one cheapo in the bag. We also have, what about castling queen side with a check? It's not often one can do that one, or maybe even going rook to d1 check. Where is the black king going to hide itself? I guess it's hiding itself on e8, where it's perfectly safe after.
Yeah, so I think there are a few things here to just point out. First of all, Gretchkina is up 20 minutes on the clock, and I think she got a position she's seen before. And the reason I say that is because e4 is a straight-up pawn sacrifice. And it's a pawn sacrifice where you're basically playing for activity, but you also forfeited the bishop pair a few moves later. So, you know, black is a pawn up and has the bishop pair. In a static position, that's a basically winning advantage, essentially. Like, a pawn is, like, in terms of computer evals, normally is one, and a bishop pair is usually, like, half a pawn at least. So this requires very concrete play to justify, and we see Gretchkina playing knight a4, which is the concrete justification. And so it's really a tug of war now between short-term play, the short-term trumps and demands the position. Knight b6 right now is a fork. There's the king is in the open with on d7. And the long-term play, which is the bishop pair. If black's able to extinguish this, there may be chances. But I think that given Gretchkina's time usage, we may have a situation where she knows exactly where the bodies are buried here.
Yeah. And my guess is that she is arguing that once this king hides itself on e8, she has ideas of just infiltrating on the C line, moving a rook to c1. Also, this bishop on f5, you mentioned the bishop pair, but I don't see much of a future for this bishop. In fact, he can get locked out of the game if black isn't careful. I could just see ideas like bishop to e3 and just h3, and I don't see a role for it at all. Even though white is a pawn down.
Really well said. And I think there's actually some positional danger based in that, right? Like if somehow that's knight, if we just imagine white getting a few moves in a row, a knight coming to b6, bishop eventually maybe even trading itself for its dark squared counterpart on f8, and then the rook's coming to d1 and c1, it's just winning. And so maybe black might have to play e3 in the near future just to thwart that idea, just so the bishop can participate in the defense and maybe nestle itself on c6 at some point, block a file, etc. Because now that you point that out, very concerning if that piece is out of play.
Yeah. And you shared a vision of your future, which I did not like for black at all. In fact, it made me panic somewhat just to think of this king being stuck there on e8. Remember, it's lost its castling rights as well. And I just saw a situation where the white king came up to e3, locked out this bishop, and the rooks came in. And also, one of the things that does concern me as well is that this knight does come to b6, upon which you control the c8 square. And that's a big deal, because this means that you can now just play for domination of the c line, and a rook coming to c7, and it will be in paradise. I think this is actually on a practical level, I know the bar is there in the middle, but I think this is very difficult for Anna.
Yeah, it's honestly a little nightmarish because you know your opponent has looked at this before. You're looking at this with fresher eyes, I would say, just in terms of you might not have experience or you don't recall it, and the time kind of demonstrates that. This isn't really a bluffing time expenditure, I would say. And you have practical problems to solve. I think bishop b4 check is going to happen regardless. It just seems like you have to try and connect your rook somehow. And then I'm wondering, do you bring your h rook to c8? Or sorry, not c8. Well, yeah, bishop back, I might take, actually.
Or king to e2. So these are the kind of questions. King e2, so king e2.
And now here's the problem. What do you do?
Solve that one.
Unpleasant.
So you got to move your... This bishop actually doesn't have so many squares. Okay, so let's try to be... Okay, so I was thinking king e7 or something.
Okay, so king e7, I guess...
Keep rooks connected.
I'm compelled to go rook ac1.
Can you not
C7.
Go knight b6 first?
Well, I kind of like rook c1 just because I don't know if I want my knight on b6 or c5. And if you go rook c8, then I'll go knight b6. Because then I'll kind of guarantee that I have that file.
And then you're in.
Yeah. So I wasn't sure whether to commit the knight first or not. So I'm going to take the file rook c1. And then I just don't know what happens next. It feels very shaky.
I guess you have to maybe go with this rook.
Wow, so you're inviting knight b6 in this way as well, but yes, you're gonna trade on c1. So
I'm gonna trade on c1 and
now I'm threatening rook c7.
Yeah. Living on the back row.
And I guess rook c7, you do have king e8. So maybe but the question is that this position just looks unpleasant. Like I was considering something like knight c4 with the idea I might be compelled to go for opposite colored bishop endgame with knight d6 check and have this really dangerous e-pawn.
I'm really attracted to this idea of just going h3, playing it super positional. I just want to stop this bishop coming to g4. That was my only plan. Nothing more sophisticated than that. And then I'm not afraid of this opposite color bishop. So if you try to get rid of this piece, I was just going to go bishop to e3 because the king can't really move. This rook certainly can't move. This bishop on f5, useless because I've played h3.
It's an elegant domination.
I'm loving this.
It's elegant domination. Can we make a few moves? Because I want to show something that's kind of funny that illustrates your point. So let's say you go h3 here, and then bishop a5, trying to trade the knight, and then bishop e3, as you suggest. And let's say, you know, f6. Again, not a good move, but I just want to show it. And then let's say I go a3. Again, these are not serious moves. I just want to show something kind of funny. So let's say a3, and then bishop takes b6, bishop takes b6, f takes e5. And black would be two pawns up, but the bishop would be so bad and the pieces would be so, white's rook and bishop would be so much better. This would just be a clearly winning position. And you could play Pac-Man eventually with those e-pawns. But eventually you'll just focus on just the domination and the pawn on g7. This would be a clearly winning position. So I see the contours of your vision there, Jovi.
Yeah, I'm at heart a very simple person. I just want to dominate the position. And that's a big, actually, I know we laugh about it and we smile about it, but it's actually a real fear that Anna will have. And that's the big issue in her game. Knight a4, bishop b4. I mean, looks the most natural move, I agree. Force the king up. And then literally, how are we going to get out of this problem?
Yeah, it's a problem.
You have to go here, and then rook, you just went rook ac1. Happy days.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the definition of unpleasant. It just must be said that Anna got caught out here. Now, to me, if you did not know what follows, or if you did not look at this position before, I must say that knight takes e5 would not have been a move on my radar. I would have gone for bishop d6 in that position. If we go back to move, I think knight e5, move 8. I would have played bishop d6 or bishop b4, something that essentially says, yeah, I might have a backward pawn, but you took two moves you moved a piece twice to do that, and I'm going to castle and maybe have a slight structural deficiency, but all my other pieces will be normal. Alas, that's not what actually wound up happening, but that would be the more practical choice. She chose the sharpest path in some respects. The imbalance that happened with the double e pawns was going to be sharp regardless. So that's why I'm surprised.
But I think that is to do with the fact that e4, I'm going to have my hands up here and say I would have also gone for knight takes knight.
Really?
Because instinctively, I don't want that knight on e5. And this e4 move, it's sacrificing a pawn. It's almost like an invisible move.
I wouldn't
have thought about it at all, right? Because you've got it covered by your pawn and your bishop. Why would white play e3 and then e4?
So what you're saying about the invisible move thing makes a total sense to me. My counter to that would be, I don't have a rebuttal to that point, but my counter would be that the knight on e5 was not going to be very stable because the bishop on f4 was there. It couldn't be supported with f4 easily. So I could have gradually gone bishop d6, a6, queen b8 or something. Like the knight wouldn't have stayed there for that long. So that would be my thing. It's like, it's there, but it's just chilling. It doesn't have its foot on my couch or anything. It's just, it's well behaved.
It's true. I'm going to agree with you there, but I'm also going to argue, just to try to rebut your point, that if you do put the bishop on d6, the move that would immediately jump to my mind is bishop to b5.
Oh, and then we're sacking that pawn. You're sacking that pawn. Yeah.
Instantly. You see, as a pawn grabber, I'm like, no.
Okay.
Into my radar. But yeah, it's very important to note that you probably should be sacking that pawn.
There are actually a lot of exchange Slav positions where you actually do lose the B pawn, or in this case, it would become a C pawn in order to kind of break the symmetry in a way where you equalize. So it's a common theme. There's actually a game from the World Championship match, I remember this, between Kramnik and Anand, between one of their matches, where one of the first few games, I don't know if it was game one or game two, someone in the chat can look it up and tell us, but in one of those games, there was an early exchange Slav where they gave up the pawn in a similar fashion. So that's where my mind was drawn to it.
Yep. Interesting, but it's actually a lesson for us all. Unfortunately, it's come at the expense of Anna Mizichuk, because if we go to the game position, we see that she does have a very unpleasant choice here. White is threatening knight to b6. She's threatening to come in with the rook to c1. And there's issues to resolve with this king there on d7. And this bishop on f5 is in danger of getting locked out. So all of these practical problems, the most pressing one being this king there saddled there on d7 and this rook on a8. So decision time for Anna. She now will have to find some very accurate moves in order to not be significantly worse. So on that note, shall we leave Anna to think a little bit more and go back to our bird's eye view and see what other developments have taken place?
Absolutely. I was just peeking. I was peeking at something in the bird's eye that really caught my eye, and I think it's really cool and instructive. I would love to go to the Tan Zhongyi game, because she played a move that is really one of those signs that you're a master Carlsbad structure player, and she won yesterday doing this. And now that night on c3, we were saying wasn't good. Right? We were saying it was questionable. It was the problem in White's position. Knight a2 is brilliant, and it's brilliant for a few different reasons. One is because there's going to be trouble on the c file. Rook c8 is going to happen. The queen is lined up on the on c7. You need to some reinforce the c pawn at some point. The other thing is that one of the ways you get the knight to d3 or d6 is by sometimes going for knight c1. So you can, if the queen moves, you can go queen e2, knight c1, knight d3, and have the stability that you need in case there's a minority attack. Because with the knight on d3, then with b5, you could plant the knight on c5. You also are overprotecting the b4 square. You can also sometimes do this with tempo with knight b4. So there's, because the knight b4, a takes b4 is a really good transformation of the pawn structure for white. Then you play c3 and your queen side is just a rock. You have that structure with the double b pawns is a rock. And so knight e2 is just one of those moves that conveys understanding, and I just got to give a golf clap. It's so cool. It's cool to see.
Yeah, it is very cool. Yeah, as a Caro-Kann player, I'm just thinking, okay, but also black doesn't have any problems whatsoever. Yes, I understand a white cut knight getting to d3 is going to be nice for that knight, but ultimately, because the pawn structure is so stable, there's no tension in the center between these pawns, black can also just get on with their merry plan of going knight to c4. Okay, but rook to c8 played.
I think that you're 100% right. It's funny. It's you're totally right about this, and black has done nothing wrong, and white is going to need help or cooperation. But I think the thing that's annoying to when you're playing against this type of Carlsbad structure right now is that essentially if you rush knight a5, I'm going to then put my knight on e5 at some point, and then I'm going to be able to justify beginning the kingside attack with like h4, rook e3, rook a1. So it's like as soon as you kind of blink first, I might get my stuff going. And then also there's again this knight b4, knight d3 business. So the question is, if you don't, let's say you don't get your minority attack going, let's just say that's the danger of getting stalled.
Right, so let's put it into practice right now. So knight a5, let's just do it.
Like, so I would go queen e2 or knight c1. Probably queen e2, okay. Actually, because I want that knight on d3.
Okay, and now I go, well, let's just put my knight onto c4.
And then I'm going to go knight b4 just to connect my rooks while I maintain the connection.
Okay, and now, I'm not going to be going b5 because I don't like this knight getting to d3, and I don't like this.
A6 is hanging.
Yeah, there's also that material issue. But in general, I'm not going to go b5 at all until the time is right. It's a late middle game plan or the end game plan, not for now. So, okay, so hang on a second. I can go a5. I can boot your knight away.
Knight d3.
Knight d3, and now I just, okay, now you're threatening to come into here, so I say knight to d7.
I'm threatening to go, I was threatening to go a4, because now I'm gonna make your pawn backwards. So I'm gonna go a4 here and cut it like that.
Uh-huh.
And I'm gonna argue that the b5 square is a sensitive much, much later.
Yeah. I can see that. And we can have a funny situation where like both sides are just waiting the other one to create some concrete action.
But here's the thing. White has more useful waiting moves than black. So white will go h4, g3, king g2, h5, rook h1. That's my concern. And there was a game in the World Championship match last year between Ding and Nepo, where Nepo played a5 and allowed this fixing on the queen side, which kind of actually I think it was a6 a5 for white, but whenever this fixing happens, it just slows down the minority attack ever so much, where even if you get b5 under the right circumstances, white can just go rook a2 and rook a1 and chill, and maybe the a pawn will be a sensitive. So that's the fear.
That is the fear. And you're right. You know, h4, I'm going to concede that. H4, g3 is a very nice way to wait. I kind of call those moves the creeping moves, because you just come up with your king to g2. And you're like, you know, this rook on e1 was doing nothing. Well, it's going to come to h1. And you're going to have to start worrying about a kingside attack. So I take your point that it's not so easy for black to wait. But it's really weird because you just look at this and you think, black's done nothing wrong. I can just wait with my rooks. I can go h6. I just have to wait for white to do something. That's one of the things that both sides actually have to do. They have to wait for the other to move, to by move, like make their intentions clear. And then you can respond in kind.
Yeah, I think what's infuriating, because again, I'm a Caracon lover as well. I know I've been playing the devil's advocate here, but the thing that's infuriating for me is you have this kingside pawn majority, and any push of the kingside pawns weakens something. If you push the e pawn, the d pawn is isolated. If you push the f pawn, then the e6 pawn is weak. If you push the g pawn, then f6 and h6 are weak. If you push h6, then if you ever need to push f6, g6 is a weakness. So that's the thing that's so annoying, is you have all of these pawn pushes and you have to kind of figure out which one am I giving something too much away that I don't necessarily want to give up. And it's just, the decisions are just so granular that it's a smart choice for an really experienced player. Yeah,
it's still plenty of battle ahead. So that was just us freestyling. So let's go back to the original board, because after c3, knight e4 was played. And I usually stay away from making a knight jump like that, because c4 is the first move that I would be considering with the white pieces. I kind of mentioned this pawn structure is all about no tension whatsoever. It's all about peace, activity and coordination. But now, if c4 is allowed, and I'm worried about moves like c5 and b4, and I have a name for this one. I call it the clamp, the big clamp. But okay, queen to e2.
Yeah, it's funny because I actually, like, the c4 idea is really clever, and it eluded me, when you mentioned it. I actually would have played queen e2, and the funny thing is I think the Carlsbad, one of the weaknesses maybe in some ways of the Carlsbad player is they want to stay in that structure, and so switching might not be, context switching might not be so easy. And knight e4 is clever because h3 has already been played, f3 will always be undesirable to kick the knight because the g3 square will be so weak. And so I think with that knight on e4, at some point, white's going to have to eradicate it by trading one of the knights, which is a small symbolic victory for black. I think black would love to trade another pair of pieces because it means the slow burn initiative won't be as dangerous. I do think that h4 and knight g5 will be the way the knight should be traded, though.
Mm-hmm. H4, knight g5. But black has to be careful again because, maybe white didn't play c4 for a particular reason, the previous move, but it's always in the air. As long as that knight stays on that square, c4 with this idea of just going c5, b4, expanding as much as possible on the queen side. And then you're not bothered about the trade of knights in that kind of scenario.
Yeah. No, the clamp, as you describe it, is very dangerous. No question about it. Yeah. So these are tough strategic decisions. Tough.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, we're going to keep a close eye on that one. And now the ball is in Vaishali's court. She has to decide what she's going to be doing. Will she be going for a minority attack? Will she be simply playing in the center? Back to the bird's eye view. What about the other two games? Maybe we can revisit the game between Katarina Lagno and Humpy Kanaru.
Let's go for it.
And these two are, I think, the two oldest players in the competition.
Okay, we've had some developments here. We last left it off with like rook takes a8, bishop takes a8, and a pawn got to a3, a white pawn got to a3, a black pawn got to d5. Ah, knight a3. Okay, I'm not familiar with this one. I'm normally that knight comes to c3 to hit the b5, but this might be a little novelty shop from Lucknow. I'd actually be very curious if knight a3 is a novelty or if it's at least a very rare move, because I've seen dozens of games with knight c3, never knight a3. And very concrete play here, bishop takes a3. Would you give up that bishop, Jovi?
No. I like my bishops. I would go queen b8. Reason I would not be making moves like b4 is because I don't want to be conceding the c4 square. That's as simple as that. Just want to go queen to b8, curl up in that proverbial little ball and see what white is doing. I can leave that one for later, right? That knight is going nowhere.
Yeah, actually...
Unless he was worried about c3 and then some knight c2.
Yeah, it's interesting because... it's so concrete, and of course, Humpy, you know, has such a fine positional understanding that she must have determined that the bishop pair that she's giving up would be compensated by some activity. And so she took on a3 to insist on getting the d5 break. And the question is, how correct was that? Or essentially, how legitimate is that kind of like tug of war of strengths in the position going to be the case? Because if we now go to the main position, which is after bishop takes a3, b takes a3, d5, black has succeeded in getting this break. The bishop on a8 might have some life yet, but bishops are bishops.
It's a concrete position. Let's dive in and start calculating, because the first move that I'm looking at is let's open things up. Yes, please. Knights are worse than bishops in open positions. That's what they say. Guess you take that with your, unless you've got some funny move. I don't see any funny. Maybe knight a5.
Yeah, no, I would trust recapturing that pawn.
Okay.
Knight a5 is an idea in a lot of those structures, but it's like you already gave up the bishop pair. Now you're trying to get it back immediately. It's different.
Okay. Knight takes. And now what? Now what? So first, I would be drawn to going bishop to b2, mm-hmm. targeting e5.
Yeah.
I'm always trying, but I'm always failing to look at the forcing moves as well.
So yeah, I think.
What forcing moves are there?
Yeah, I think bishop b2, I think it might, bishop b2 might be well met by f6, actually, if you can get away with that pin for just a move. I don't know if you can, so I might just be, but if you'd love to play f6 on one of the upcoming moves, maybe you have to start with queen d6, but if you can get away with it and just get in king h8 on the next move, the bishop on b2 will just be neutralized. I'm very worried about this, some break in the center to punish this king on g8, but I don't know. Maybe f6 is fine. The move that actually was screaming out to me after bishop, after knight takes e5 was knight g5, actually, because we were talking about f7 being sensitive before. And if you let me get in queen h5, I'm going to start to mash a little bit. And even the non-attacker in me can see that there's some threats around that king that is relatively uncovered.
Actually, you know, because we can look at one of them, which is like h6, and then, woo, knight takes f7. We've seen that trick before.
Oh, snap. This is like fried liver style, right?
Exactly. King takes knight, and then this queen will come to f3 check, and this knight will fall. So
wait, does it fall? Knight? Does it fall? What if the king goes to e6? How does the knight fall? I don't even know.
I just... It doesn't do well in the fried liver. And I'm sure it's not going to do so well here. Okay, no, I just admit, I thought that they would fall. I thought there's no way that the king can act like that Spartan warrior and live in the
center. Wow, bishop b2. Hold on, hold the phone. Okay, I can see for sure that black's king is in a terrible way and that hardly any of black's pieces can move. I still don't see us winning the piece yet. That's all I'm saying.
But you can't move. You can't move because rook f8 is going to be met by bishop takes knight.
You're threatening d4. I see that. You're threatening d4, right?
Yep. I'm also stopping this knight from moving. So rook takes e5 is in the air.
trouble in paradise, essentially.
Yeah, I mean, I just stopped here and I was like, there's no way that this king can survive on e6.
Fair. So we can assume Humpy will also stop and not even remotely consider h6. But then knight g5 is quite serious then, because again, queen h5 is still a threat. You can't go knight f6 back because the f7 pawn is weak. So you might have to go something like rook e7 or rook f8 to cover f7. I don't see any other way. But then my queen h5 stuff might be interesting, though.
Yeah, but then h6. h6 occurs.
My knight can come back. I can attack the e5 pawn. I don't know. It's. I can see that the eval bar really is kind of laughing at me. But
yeah, but the eval bar is like cold blooded. A human is not so cold blooded, and especially Humpy will be very, very stressed in this type of position, because with his pawn on h6, you've got ideas of going bishop takes h6, is rook lifting up, and yeah, I'm excited about White's chances here.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's a scary option. There might be even more interesting options with, instead of knight g5. That was just the most direct way. It's funny because I do think in most of the positions you are going to start with e5, because d4, d4 is probably a good transformation for black. Just the e pawn wouldn't be a target. Here it is a target. Interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah.
Here's an interesting idea, I think. So we were talking about knight a5 before, sometimes hitting this bishop, and black's a pawn on the board, when there was this pawn tension on the a file, and I was mentioning this bishop d2 idea to stop knight a5.
Yeah,
I could see bishop d2 just being useful, developing prophylaxis, and then even going queen a1 to hit the e5 pawn that way. Point being that if you go f6 to defend like before, then queen a2 adds more pressure to the pin piece. And yes. So that might also be a bit of a scary thing to deal with. Just a little geometry there for the folks at home. Let's say black goes bishop b7, just a passing move just for folks to see it. So if queen a1 now, hitting that e5 pawn three times, f6 defending that pawn, and then queen a2, look at that, and then you have this nice battery lined up against the king on g8, and that is geometry, folks. So
that is very nice geometry. Unfortunately, black does have this move knight cd7, but even then you have to be looking at those moves that break things open, like c4.
Hey, at least it looked cool. It looked cool.
It looks dangerous as anything. I would not be going into this voluntarily, but I love this queen a1 idea, because it's not very natural to kind of just tuck the queen into your own corner and then use that as a springboard to get to a better square. It's unusual.
Right. Yeah.
Well. So this is the position, d5. What do you think? E takes d5. Also, yes, she's taking it. She's going for it. And I predict Katarina will go knight to g5. It's irresistible.
Really? Really? That? Yeah. It does ask direct questions. So
you force the rook. Because if the best move is after knight takes d5, knight g5, is the best move is to go rook e7 or rook to f8? Let's put the rook back to, like...
Yeah, I would go.
Then you've made life easier for yourself, right? The rook has wasted time. E8, f8.
The one counter to that, though, is that if black makes a few good defensive moves, which we know Humpy is very capable of doing, I mean, it's weird to say almost, but I feel like white is a few moves behind development wise. Because again, the bishop on c1 is still at home. I also would love if I could get an h3 in one of these positions, because it feels just like my king is just a little bit loose if there's some type of skirmish in the center. And I like the bishop on a8 just looking at g2. It's something where at some point the knight on c6 goes to d4 with tempo, and then you have these like martial style positions with the bishop bearing down on the diagonal. So I feel like that's the concern that I have.
Yeah, I feel your concern, but I do feel that this is one of those move-based positions where you have to just go into the detail. So the first move is like queen h5, right? Because it's scary stuff. And if you're going to go h6, because you need to be covering the h7 pawn, because checkmate was being threatened, if you just made a passing move, just to highlight that, if you just waited bishop b7, queen takes h7, whoops, would be checkmate. So you don't want to be allowing that. And so h6, and now I was thinking, okay, let's get that knight to either e4 or to f3, and then let me try to sacrifice things. I'm sorry. When I'm a commentator, I don't have any stress about sacrificing pieces. I just want to look at all the brutal lines.
So what are we sacrificing?
Queen bishop takes h6 is my big idea.
Oh.
Yeah.
That is scary.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. Okay.
I want to go, if you allow me, bishop takes h6, and I want to go up with the rook and over.
So I have some, okay. So I guess I have to kick your knight because my queen can't even support the h6 pawn yet because the knight on d5 is hanging. So I guess I would go knight f6 to hit your queen, ask that question.
Yeah, that's the only thing that I see. Okay, now the queen wants to stay somewhere close.
Are you going to go queen h4 or queen h3?
Either queen f5 or queen h4.
Hmm.
Queen f5 just has the idea of winning the a5 pawn. Let's go queen h4 because, you know, I'm going to be persistent with this idea of going.
I don't know. I don't know for me. I have no idea.
I'm just looking at, like, if you defend this, okay, bishop. Okay, if you go rook e8 to defend e5, bishop takes h6.
Yeah, this looks a little bit much
because there's queen
g6. That's a pin, folks. See that diagonal there? That queen cannot be captured because the bishop on b3 is bearing down. So, looks like scary hours to me. Knight g5 definitely has enough venom that you might just be like, you know what? That's where we're going to go. That's where we're going to go with it.
Yeah, and the fact that Humpy is hesitating to take on d5 suggests to me that maybe she is planning knight to a5. Maybe this was her big idea after all. Remember, Humpy, from my experience in observing her play, she doesn't tend to like being attacked, getting these kind of risky positions where her king is exposed.
Yeah. I mean, I would get being a pawn down if the bishop on on a8 became active. But the problem here is that white, I think, would reinforce the d5 pawn with c4, and the same problems would be there. The e5 pawn would still be hanging. The bishop on a8 would still be blocked. So I'm all for the martial compensation if the bishop has the nice long diagonal, and I'm not sure it's going to get it here. That's my concern with the knight a5 business.
Yeah, it was just because of her hesitation. I just thought maybe we need to consider knight to a5. But we're going to... What a tense position, because somehow my eyes are drawn now to this. And
What'd she play?
Knight to d4.
Ah. Whoa! Okay.
Well, isn't this your idea of c4?
Well, you know what? This one actually makes a little bit more sense to me than the knight a5 idea, because at least here you're kind of inviting white to maybe take on d4. Like, there's more interesting options here. You could still take on e5. You could take on d4. You can get distracted from not going and not go c4. Interesting. Very interesting choice. I think Lucknow is going to think here for at least 10 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes, because this is a critical position in the game. There's like three or four options. You're already a pawn up. You have the two bishops. Maybe you could sense a little something's in the air. I think we should move from this one and go to another. But this is the first major decision for Lucknow in this game.
Yes. Yeah, big decision. I must admit, I'm grudgingly moving away because I can't wait to find out what happens next from this game. But back to our bird's eye view, and we can see that, well, things are shaping up pretty nicely, but we should check in on the game between Salimova against Leighton Jay.
All right. Been a minute since we checked that one. And we're gonna bring that to you just in a second. Here we are. Okay. It looks still very Queen's Gambit accepted-ish. A lot of symmetry. Who do you like?
I think it's objectively equal, but I like white's chances. I know this knight on d4 doesn't do much, but it's looking pretty. It can't be chased away. And this pawn on a6 is a target. But then on the other hand, black can go a5 and just cement this bishop on b4. And then what is this rook on a4 doing? So, maybe I changed my mind. Am I allowed to change my mind?
Yes, we are allowed to do anything. We and on this broadcast, we can change our mind, we can sing, we can scream. Well, maybe not scream, but we have liberties.
Okay, I think that it's actually probably just equal, but I think it's maybe after moves like a5, it's going to be maybe a little bit easier for black to play.
Yeah, it's funny because I actually kind of was liking black a little bit. Just because I think there are more ways that black can go wrong. In my mind, I'm thinking, okay, maybe that rook is it a strength on a4 or is it a liability? Like if a5, do we lock out? Are we locking out that rook? Because I think your instinct with white might be to, okay, I want to double rooks in the a file, but it's like, is that impressive if the rook on a4 is kind of caught? And
Exactly.
I don't know. It's a weird because I can also see if the bishop if you just remove the bishops from the board, the dark squared bishops, that is, then I'd want white because then there'd be knight d6 hitting the light squared bishop. There it wouldn't have any squares and it'd be a slightly different dynamic. Then the bishop on f3 would hit the one on d5. So I think that position really comes down to the dark squared bishops here. It's what's holding black's position together.
Yes. Well, on that note, you just I never even thought about bishop a3, which is really bad because I was thinking about bishop c1 and bishop d2, but why takes two moves to do something you can do in one? But that's actually a serious threat.
Yeah, I think that this was the one I was staring at, but I was wondering, okay, how impressive is that if I go A5 and I just
If you go
say,
a5 now, then I can't do it. There's no way that you can go bishop a3. But if black wastes move, let's
let's
just
say
make a random
H6.
move. H, yeah,
H6.
h6, just to waste that time. And now bishop a3.
But even here, A5. How bad can it be? I'm going to argue
No.
that maybe after AB4, I might have some knight C3 action. Maybe we just trade everything on the A file. I don't know.
Yeah. This bishop feels. This knight could come to d6.
Ah, okay. I forgot about this knight d6 business
Yeah.
already. I have bishop a6 though, maybe. But it's getting shaky. I admit that. I mean, that's I'm basically getting a little bit more than I bargained for. So yeah, maybe a5 is not the sensible move if after a pass. But it's certainly a5 certainly a sensible move if you don't go h6. So yeah,
Yeah,
interesting.
so rook takes a4. Okay, so now the question is, a5 to me is the most logical move because of this bishop a3. Anyway, I was instinctively wanting to play a5 just to anchor this bishop on b4. And now we can just kind of cut out the theoretical possibilities of bishop a3 because then this knight just comes to b6. No problemo at all.
Right. Yeah. So there might be a little bit of a fizzle here. I think we'll see how ambitious the players want to get in a very, very, very symmetrical position. yeah, we'll see. The next few moves will tell the tale for sure. So
okay. So, okay, this is perhaps the only position where there's not so much danger, because we have all these different positions where there's different types of danger. We have the all-out potential attack that Humpy Canary was facing against Katarina Lagno, and it was more of a strategic, dangerous game between Tang Zhongyi and Vaishali. And maybe we can check in on the game between Goryashkina and Anna Mezuchuk.
Yeah. And drama. Again, this is not at all, I think, what Mezuchuk hoped to get out of the opening here. Only one move has been played, right, since knight a4. It's just rook b8. So elected to not play bishop b4 check. Maybe the bishop's on a better square. Maybe it just is not a very helpful move. But rook b8 is a brave move, demonstrates some restraint, gets out of the knight b6 fork that was going to happen, but still very, very dangerous position.
Completely dangerous. But I mean, the only thing now is that Goryashkina is thinking. And I think when you have a position as fraught as this, then it's very good news that your opponent is thinking that they're now having to use their own brain power, because it's scary just facing an opponent who's just wheeling out the moves instantaneously and in this type of position as well. I mean, my eye is drawn to knight to b6 regardless, with this idea of just stepping up with the king, taking control of the c line, and asking black how are they going to complete their development. Still very dangerous position, despite what the evaluation bar is indicating, that's relatively balanced. On a practical level, no, not at all.
Not at all. Not at all.
But an exciting game nonetheless. And of course, we will be keeping a close eye on this one. And anyhow, I have exciting news for you, because something new is coming your way. And it's been seen on Shark Tank. But the Chess Up team has returned with a brand new Chess Up 2, an electronic chessboard that combines the best of online and over-the-board chess with built-in Wi-Fi and Chess.com compatibility. Chess Up 2 carries all the convenience of online gaming, like access to the millions of players in the online chess community, without losing the unique experience and feel of over-the-board chess. And when you've finished a match on the board, you can save games directly on Chess.com and analyze online. To learn more about Chess Up 2 and save $100 when you pre-order on Kickstarter, head to go.chess.com/chessup2 or use !chessup in chat. And on that exciting note, we are going to leave you for a quick break, but don't go anywhere, because we are going to catch up with all the excitement in just a few minutes.
Any good chess tactics book has one pattern in it that feels like it is on a completely different level than all of the other tactical patterns. Bearing the vivid and accurate moniker, the windmill, this pattern features an amazing sequence of repeated discovered checks that can be used to win a nearly unlimited amount of material. The most famous windmill is definitely the one played by Mexican prodigy Carlos Torre against former world champion Emmanuel Lasker. But Bobby Fischer's game of the century also features a windmill. Here's another one that I really like. White starts with a rook sacrifice that leads to a combination of bishop and rook checks that simply consume black's forces. The Lafong is a dirty, dirty trick that will probably only work at bullet, but you have to pull it off at least once in your life. When you sense that your opponent is pre-moving g6 and bishop g7 to start the game, you can play d4 and bishop h6 to try to win the bishop on g7.
Shakes, guys. No one is watching. Oh, they all missed that. I see the tilt. I can feel the tilt.
It is a high risk and high reward strategy because you are hanging your own bishop if you don't catch them in a pre-move. But it is certainly hilarious when you do pull it off.
Like one of my friends, Asios, he made a bot. The report chart was partly based on hyperbullet games. So then you can see a lot of the Lafongs and Queen C2 takes H7 and so on. Yeah. So.
Do you guys play chess? You want to talk about it?
Yes.
Let's do. Oh yeah. Where do you play chess at?
In our room.
Okay. When I say chess, the first word that pops into your mind?
Protect my queen.
Hikaru.
Intelligence.
Strategy.
Tactics.
Toby Maguire.
Oh my God! You saw pawn sacrifice?
Yeah.
If you're on Tinder and you're scrolling and someone has a chess player on their profile, is that swipe left or swipe right?
Swipe right is good, right?
Yeah.
Then yeah.
Instant swipe right.
Okay, super into that.
Right, I'm into it. Yeah.
You're into chess, yeah. Okay.
Probably whatever the swipe is, I'm not interested.
You're not interested in chess players?
I'm not interested in chess players who are on Tinder.
Oh, I get that. In fact, that checks out. If I ask you to name one chess player in the world, can you name a chess player?
Yep.
No,
I cannot. Anna Taylor-Joy.
Capablanca.
Wow, name another one.
Oh, Kasparov.
If you name five other world champions in the next 15 seconds, I'm gonna give you $50.
Karpov, Spassky, Polgar, Carlsen, and Anand.
Holy shit, he did it. You get $50, dude. Oh my God, we just lost $50. Whose idea was that?
And we are back for round two of the women's candidates in Toronto. And boy, has it been tense. We've seen all types of positions. We've seen Humpy Canary struggling against Katarina Legno. We've also seen Anna Mizichuk be surprised against Alexandra Grashkina. And one other game that we were very closely monitoring was that between Tan Zhongyi and Vaishali. I predicted that this would be a game full of fireworks, full of danger, full of chaos. I'm not quite sure we're seeing that. Oh, but we're seeing danger in another form, aren't we, Kasa?
Yeah. No, it's really been interesting. Carlsbad structure again. Tan Zhongyi with the black pieces had a Carlsbad structure, the black side of that structure yesterday, and won a really nice game. And she's elected to basically play the same structure today with the white pieces. And it's one of those things that's really challenging to navigate. And I think here, Vaishali has basically forfeited any hopes of counterplay on the queen side, because even though the black pawn is on a4 now, the B pawn on B7 will never be able to kind of chisel away at the queen side structure. And so you have an issue where this play is going to shift completely to the to the king side, and it's usually on that side that white tries to actually expand and hope for a king side attack, like Tan Zhongyi got off yesterday. So very, very scary time just to contend with that. And F3 is a little bit of an interesting move, though, because we mentioned that with H3 already being played, the squares around the king are a little bit weak. And so I was a little bit surprised by F3. If you can try to trade that knight on E4, usually you do it with H4 and knight F3 to G5. And then the hope is that you don't touch that F pawn, which gets in the way of rook lifts on the third rank. So I think Vaishali is still worse, but definitely got off a little bit easier here, because I think now, in order for the kingside attack to work, the rook is going to have to enter through the H file.
Yeah. And yeah, but the thing is, though, Vaishali, in order to dislodge these knights, they're all very, very awkward. She's going to have to go F6 at some stage and create a weakness of her own that she needs to defend. And let's not forget, like you've been mentioning, that white does have that free hand to go H4, H5, maybe even go all the way up to H6. And see how far it can go. I love your idea of getting that rook to the H line. And this knight on D3 is just a fantastic defender. It's covering B2. Excellent job there. And now this queen can just move over to the king side to engage in an attack. I'm very, very worried in this position. I don't like A4. I'm kind of curious, though. How was Vaishali tempted or tricked into making this move?
Yeah, where
we left it round about knight to A5, yeah, and knight to B4, and here I was looking at knight C4, I mean, these type of ideas, and then just waiting. But Vaishali went knight to B3, and now after the move rook AD1, A5, knight D3, she's left her knight on B3, and she has to rescue it. It's got no squares.
Yeah, and I think that was the issue, is that white's essentially, I think, threatening something along the lines of like A4 and queen C2, maybe, or honestly, that knight on B3 is simply can be ignored. It's, I love this rook AD1 move, because, you know, a little geometry for the folks at home. If your piece is two diagonals away from a knight, you can't be touched for three moves, minimum three moves. And so that two diagonals away is the perfect distance to evade a knight for a period of time. And with that, it reminds me, there are some positions where you have a knight on B4, like, and it's like an outposted knight, but all the play is coming on the other side. And so you're like, whatever. And this is a very similar dynamic where I think Vaishali realized, oh my gosh, my knight's not doing anything. And B5, B4 is simply not on the agenda with the knight on D3 there, because you don't actually have to touch your C pawn. You can play A takes B4 and then knight takes B4. And so those factors meant she had to switch it up. Vaishali was like, I need to adjust to this theme, to the new terms and conditions. And she maybe made her position worse.
Yeah, she certainly made it kind of almost like a two result game, because now she's just waiting for Tan Zhongyi to strike on the king side, knight f3, knight to d6, and how to go about building this. So I was thinking h4, is that too soon?
I love h4. I think h4 makes a lot of sense. A knight f5 is going to happen by hook or by crook. I think like it's gonna happen. So you can consider being prophylactic and going queen f2 just to kind of stop that idea before it becomes an idea, because now after if you go knight f5, I might even consider g4, honestly. That's how ambitious I might be compelled. I might also just put the knight back on g4 at some point. But h4, g4, these are the moves, and then you bring your king to g2, you swing the rook to h1, and it's on. So
h4, g2, rook h1, and it's business time, yeah, on the king side. But I mean, how dangerous is it if I try to go into the swapping game?
Yeah, so you gotta try to trade the minor pieces. It's a sensible thing. White should try to keep tension. So I think you could still go h4, but even knight g4, essentially saying, your knights are struggling on the queen side. They're not doing much. So I'm going to just keep that tension in the air. Both are appropriate in the position.
Yeah. Yeah, it's Vaishali's position would be okay if all these knights were swapped off. But the presence of knights make it very, very tricky. I mean, I would be tempted just to go knight to e7, try to get a knight somewhere on f5, leave that knight on d6. It's okay for the time being. But then again, there's still the h4, h5 idea. No way to answer that.
You know, this is crazy, but I'm going to say it anyway. It's crazy, and it's probably bad. But if you did give Black a few moves, a few moves in a row, I would be interested in knight f5 and h5, and then h4 to try and fix the kingside, white's kingside pawns, and kind of create like a little tentpole situation on the kingside. I just don't think there's time for it, but that would be really compelling.
Yeah. Okay. So let's get that in operation. Let's go knight to f5.
Let's say king h1 is played. Let's just say a bad. Oh no, wait. King h1. Then there's knight b knight g3. But I was trying to make a nothing burger move. Let's say like I don't know rook c1 or something.
And yeah. Then... Let's try to do it like. Let's try to anticipate because you can't stop h5.
Well, I think. Probably if I'm white here, I the only way I can reasonably stop it is or deter it is by kicking the knight. So I would probably consider going knight e3 just so that if I trading one pair of knights here still does not solve Black's position is still a bit compromised because mm-hmm. if you trade those knights, I'm going to take with the rook. And okay, of course, h5 is out of the question now. But again, there's still this very simple plan now of doubling rooks and proceeding onward with this h4, h5 business. And it's hard. It's just hard, man. it's really annoying to deal with this stuff. And I think the key thing for when you're doing the minority tack against the Carlsbad structure, a really, really important theme, I cannot say it enough, is do not lock the pawns. It seems so tempting to lock the pawns on the queen side, but you actually really want to have the option of breaking, even if it's at the cost of a pawn sacrifice. So locking the pawns shifts the game to one side of the board and
balance. You gotta have it's the yin and yang, you know. You've got to think of those scales and just keep it dynamically balanced where possible, because this is what the pawn structure is telling us. The pawn structure is telling us that Black wants to be playing on the queen side, and like you say, if you lock it up, that's it. You can kiss goodbye to any chance of a queen side attack, whereas White has that free hand to start just maneuvering the pieces. So yeah, this is a really dangerous position. And we have a move from Tan Zhongyi. She's just played knight to f4, getting ready. I'm just wondering whether she's going to go queen f2. Your idea of going h4, h5.
I must say, I'm so impressed by knight f4. Like, it's such a good move. And the reason it's so good is because we were talking about Black needing to try to trade a minor piece. The knight on e5 is actually a tradable piece. By positioning the knights on d3 and f4, neither of them can be touched. How can you trade the knight on d3 away? How can you touch it? Same thing with the knight on f4. So the knights are unassailable there, and that's what's happening now. Then how can you push the f-pawn ever or push the e-pawn? The knight on f4 looks at the d5 pawn, and it also looks at the e6 pawn, so the breaks aren't there. And then we're talking about this knight f5, knight g3 business. Well, now the knight on f4 blocks the diagonal of the queen from c7. So you're basically just controlling the remnants of counterplay that exist so that you can ultimately get off the attack you want to get off. It's really patient, clever maneuvering. And I think, again, Tan Zhongyi is really an expert in the Carlsbad.
Yeah. Yeah, she really is. She's got a great feel for what pieces to trade. But there's one thing I'm going to say about this position for Black. Black's position is still rock solid, but it's passive. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, Vaishali has to forget any idea of initiating a queenside attack. Instead, she just has to perhaps leave a knight on c4 and focus on getting ready for the impending pawn advance or the positioning of white's pieces towards her king. If she can do that, it's that whole principle. When you're playing against one side, if you only have one weakness, you can defend that one weakness with all your might. So white, luckily for Black, white isn't going to be able to create that second weakness. It's just going to be miserable, but needs must.
So I'm going to tell you actually something about defending this type of position, because I'm going to give a special shout out to Matthew Sadler, who in his book Game Changer had a whole chapter on the Carlsbad, which taught me a lot personally. Mm-hmm. And many of these engine matches where they played the Carlsbad structure, the way that the computer would try to defend against the slow rolling attack is to go h6, king h7, and rook h8. And the idea is that then when, let's say, the white pawn's on h5 and you're building up towards g5, okay,
let's put that on the board.
Let's say h4. We're going to make some bad moves, but.
Yeah, okay, yeah. So knight ed3, and then let's go. Okay, let's make a passing move. Let's just wait with the queen just for fun. And then, yeah. Oh no, hang on, I've stopped h4. Okay, let's just put h4.
Let's just ignore the moves. Yeah.
H6. Yeah, yeah, just ignore it. And then, okay, so let's go h6, and now h5.
h5, king h7.
King h7.
g4.
Yep.
Rook h8. And then king, let's say king h2. Again, we see queen h4's yes. move, but let's say just get the rook to g, just double the rooks on the g file and play king h3. And there are so many positions where king, this construction would be the plan. This rook h8, king h7 business. You'd probably start with king h3, rook g1, and so on. Rooks just wait, yeah, shuffle. Wait, yeah. And, mm-hmm. and double rooks and whatever. And then the point is that eventually it looks like g5 is just coming, but the point is that Black's king is going to try to evacuate with king g8 and so on, and the rook will actually have the file bearing down on the king on h3. But the point was that at the moment that this king h7, rook h8 business happened, then you focus your efforts elsewhere because Black tied themselves into a pretzel to defend against that. So then it would be mm-hmm. like, oh, now we're going to go knight c5 and look at the a4 pawn or queen d1 or something like that and tickle that way. And then once you defend it that way, then we'll switch back and then finally we'll break through. Or even here, I could see something like the white king going king g2, king f1, king e1, running to the a2, to the queen side, and then playing g5. And you have this mystifying dynamic where white is basically tickling on both fronts constantly. And it's like a death by 1,000 cuts.
Do you know, the funny thing is, okay, I'm looking at the engine because I'm kind of curious as to what its valuation is on this particular position. And it says that it's completely level after rook h8. You're like, hello?
But look at Black, but what are Black's moves though, right? Like the active plans, like if Black is just, the computer could say, rook, in a lot of these positions, they'll just shuffle and they won't appreciate the breakthrough until it slaps them in the face. So that's the question.
Well, this was the thing, you know, I was like, okay, how can it be that you've played like the most ridiculous moves in the world, like rook h8, king h7, now you've gone rook h8, you just shuffled with the queen, ultimate waiting moves. And here you can just walk the king over there and the computer goes, no, it's fine. It's just, sometimes chess is just weird, Casa.
Yeah, no question.
But so anyway
unpleasant
task ahead, because again, one of the lessons that I've learned in chess is never ever underestimate the ability of someone, including myself, to go wrong in a completely normal position. And this is ultimately, it's unpleasant, but it is still solid and okay for Vaishali. But I can just see her breaking out with f6 at the wrong time. I can see her waiting in the wrong move. just because it is psychologically so difficult to play these type of positions.
No doubt. So this one will see. Yeah, so again, the knights now are positioned really well. I think after knight ac4 here, knight ed3 was played. You could see if you play this knight e3, right? I think it was played.
Yeah, knight ed3, and I can see g4 being played.
Yeah,
and that is Tan's type of chess. G4, king g2, and I guess you probably have to react in either an extraordinary way or just sit there and just accept that white is going to push as hard as they can, and you just have to wait for that. And I mentioned it once and I mentioned it again. This is very, very difficult to do. So Vaishali, practically big task ahead of her. Shall we go and check on the other games?
Yeah, what are you liking? What are you looking at?
Yeah, I'm looking at, can we go and revisit the Lagno against Canero game?
All right.
Because where we left it on knight to d4, cliffhanger.
Yeah.
Because it looked like Katarina could just play c4 and just solidify her extra pawn in the middle. But I'm looking at this position and I'm thinking that didn't happen. C4 was not played.
Yeah, she definitely took on d4, it looks like. Yeah. And then, to be honest, that looks good for white too. So I'm trying to figure out, I mean, white has the bishop pair and is probably going to lose the pawn on d5, but has a bishop pair. So that has to count for something. The problem is that black is going to basically neutralize the bishop pair momentarily if Humpy gets the chance to play bishop takes d5 and then swap those bishops, then you can say, well, the worst is behind her. And so this might have been a critical position.
She played bishop g5,
mm-hmm,
with the idea that after bishop takes d5, rook takes e8, queen takes e8, only move. And now, presumably, bishop takes f6 is the big idea.
So the question is with this big idea, we're going to have a structure that's really interesting because it looks like white can create a passed pawn in the A file. So, and black will have double pawns on the king side. I don't think that matters too much, to be honest, in this position with just queens on the board, because it also solves black's back rank problems. But
how is this working? I got kind of a bit bogged down in the calculation after bishop.
So I think you take on b3, c takes b3, and then I think g takes f6 happens, and I think you want to go a4. You have to try and I think the hope is I have an outside passer. All pawn end games will be losing for you. And so if the queens were just magically taken off the board right now, white would have a winning position because the white king could neutralize the black pawn majority that would be formed in the center after a trade of B and A pawns, and black's king is way too far away. So I think the torture now, if I can call it that, is that white's going to go queen A1 and A5, A6, and just push him. And the question is there enough counterplay to deter from that plan?
Yeah, that is a question. And let's have a look, because this is a concrete position. Let's take that one.
I'm scared. And
I'm also very scared, but at the same time, there's a few things that give me some. Yeah, somehow they also have a passed pawn of, black also has a passed pawn of their own. Let's not forget that.
I see, my instinct here, to be honest, would be to slow down the A pawn as soon as possible. So my instinct would be to play queen C6 and to blockade that pawn ASAP on the A, like put my queen on A6 and look at the D3 pawn. The problem is I don't like that I'm just sitting there. If I go like queen C6, then maybe A5 anyway, or queen A1.
Queen A8, but that one loses immediately because, queen to G4.
Yeah, so I don't know. I honestly don't know. And actually, queen C6 must lose to queen G4 also. Well, Actually, no, it's back rank mate. Doesn't. There's a back rank mate. Okay, so
yeah,
but because so that's this is the temptation, and okay, that's too early. So I queen giving the check is we should illustrate it. But it's too early. But I still am worried here.
This is the back rank mating pattern. One of the most important mating patterns to know. I would say this is number one.
For sure.
Okay, so let's go back. Queen c6.
And I was thinking initially, okay, I'm going to go queen a1. But I thought queen c3 is a problem. And then the queen trade actually works out for me because you can't actually take it. And I'm also looking at the d3 pawn. I'm stopping pawn a5 from happening. So queen a1 didn't seem to work. And I was like, okay, queen c6 looks good. But it still feels like the a pawn is much, much stronger than the c pawn. And if I go for, if I just give my king a luft, if I go h3 or h4, maybe is actually more elegant, probably giving your king more space. I don't see the counterplay for black.
Yeah, but you don't need to have counterplay. You just have to keep this person, the a4 pawn, under lock and key. So as long as I stop it advancing to a5, say maybe I need to protect this pawn on d4. So I'm just thinking queen to b6 because I want to be going c5 at the right time.
But then what if I go queen a1 now and you don't have the queen c3 business?
Yeah, I don't have. Yeah. And if I go c5 immediately.
Then a5 and we're just going
to. This was not the way I wanted to stop your pawn, but.
Yeah, and I would go queen a3, just defend it, and it's I'm scared. With black, I want no business of calculating it, because after queen a3, I'm also looking at the c5 pawn. My a pawn is still the fastest pawn. I'm scared.
Yeah, there are some kind of. I was wondering whether there's any. There are some things like. Oops, I was thinking queen b. No, not queen b5. I was hallucinating. I was thinking c4 is what I was thinking. No, it doesn't work. Yeah, you're right to be scared.
It's one of those things where the computer might say it's equal, but this is truly a holding pattern if I've ever seen one, because the queen on a6 can't move. The pawns are basically frozen. And let's not forget that the pawns being split, which I kind of scoffed at on the king side as being kind of a nothing burger here, will be an issue in pawn endgames. Like if somehow the queens are off and the a pawn is traded for the c pawn, there are many endgames where if a king gets to f4, a white king gets to f4, opposition will be a huge issue with like pawn g4 happening at the right moment where the f pawn could just be lost. And so maybe actually objectively this was not the correct choice to go to this path that Lakhna went down, but practically it's a very, very impressive decision because it's a two result game.
It sadly is a two result game, and and from what I've seen, they are right in it. So we see a4 has been played, and now it's decision time from Humpy. Is she going to take that pawn on a4, or will she play another move? What else to play?
You know what's actually interesting? Maybe if you keep the tension for a moment, it means something. So maybe if you go like queen c6 and chill, and you say, I'm not gonna rush to capture, maybe that actually means something, because maybe a5 can be well met by queen c3, and the queen can't come to a1 to deal with defend the pawn, so maybe it just hangs. So there might be some clever-ish way to hold things together, without actually allowing this queen a1 business, which we saw. But it's still really hard to work this out. And even with the pawn on a4, I can just leave it there and give my king an escape square with h4 or h3. Probably h4, actually. And
were you on the same? I suddenly saw this idea.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I was like, why h3? Like, what are we doing here? Like, you know the other reason for h4, too? Is if there's in some perpetual check dynamics, right? Like, let's say like the queen goes to f4 and checks, my king is the h3 square from h2. Exactly. So I have more options.
Yeah. No, this is scary stuff, you know. A pawn, H pawn. No. The king is unsafe as well. This is a really tough job for Humpy to come up with a defensive plan. And what she has to do is she has to do it in stages, though. First stage is to improve the piece, stop this pawn from advancing, secure her king. I guess her king has to hide on f8.
Yeah, maybe. I honestly am. I don't want to defend this. Like, I'm like, oh my goodness. I don't.
Yeah, it's certainly easier. It's certainly easier for White to play because White's plan is so simple because it's all about pushing the a pawn, getting a hiding place for the White king, and if Black stops it, then if you're able to, you can use that unsafe position of the Black king to create another possibility of a passed pawn by advancing your h pawn. So there's a simple, straightforward plan for White. For Black, it's like stopping the a pawn, trying to secure the king, trying to get some perpetual checks against the White king. And also, let's not forget that Black does have the possibility of going c5 and c4. Maybe c5 is the move, actually.
Oh, right now?
Well, it was only because I was looking at c5 and c4 in the situations the pawn takes pawn that I was thinking, maybe c5 now. I don't know.
That's really clever because now maybe you're threatening c4 in some positions and trying to force through your own passer somehow.
Well, how is a5?
I don't know. Before I had this queen c3 idea. Now I don't have it because the c pawn's in the way. So right. I think you have to go back to the passive blockading, which was my rat beef. So yeah. I guess I would. The rule of thumb is to slow down the pawn as soon as you can. So yeah, queen a6 would be the way. And then again, this h4 business. The other thing is, like you mentioned, with this h4 business, h4, h5, h6. Don't let that pawn get to h6. Then there might be positions where White can punt on the a pawn and go queen g4, queen g7, and make a queen that way.
Yeah.
So I'm actually probably going to meet any h4 move with h5 with Black.
Yeah, I completely agree. h4, h5. But, you know, it could be a funny situation where if this position occurs, you could see the queens tied down to the a5 pawn, and it's the kings that do the heavy lifting. Like, you might see the Black king try to run over to the queen side and try to get behind the a5 pawn so that the queen can then start pushing the c5 pawn to c4, getting their own passed pawn, and White's king will be like doing something, maybe,
you know, what's funny,
the h pawn.
I think both kings will actually have to stay, won't be able to get too far, because I was thinking along your line, if the White king tries to come out, right, the queen's going to check it and then go back to a6, essentially. And if the Black king runs to as soon as it makes it to d8, to the d-file, b4 will be played. And then queen takes d4 check, and queen takes b4 will be the end of that excursion. So I think both kings will actually, they'll try, but they can't get far enough to actually meaningfully do anything.
Yeah. No, that's a nice point, but it was just me being.
No, but it's actually what you'd want to do. Like, it's actually correct. Like, if you could get your king, if the king and the queen could switch places, even, like, it wouldn't be that bad.
No, it wouldn't be bad at all, because let's not forget, Black does also have a passed pawn, right? You can create something by going c4. Well, it's an intriguing endgame, but Humpy is definitely on the back foot. So going back to the game position, a4 has been played. They're on move 20. Still, decisions. How should Humpy defend this? She's a great endgame player, so I have full faith in her. But questions, does she go queen c6, which I love? Does she make moves like c5? We'll find out. Let's leave this game simmering and let's go back to the bird's eye view and have a look at how some of the other games have turned out. Can we go to the... I can see not that much has happened between Alexander Goryashkina and Anna Muzychuk.
You want to take a gander
but because
at that
the
one?
Position, yeah, the position is so sharp.
And the time. Oh my goodness, the time.
Oh.
Folks, we have, Houston, we have a problem. Anna Muzychuk has 16 minutes left and counting and has 24 moves to go to make time control. Yikes. This is a tricky moment. Now, objectively, it must be said, she's done everything right, more or less, so far, it looks like. I mean, the bar, as you guys can see, has not changed meaningfully. It's just the practical problems. And she might have been cleverer than the both of us because she demonstrated real restraint in not playing bishop before check.
Yeah. Also, I'm impressed by Goryashkina. She didn't go knight b6 either, because I would have put that knight in to that square as quickly as possible. Let me just go back a little bit, because we left at knight a4, rook to b8, rook to d1 was played. I was obsessed with putting that knight on b6 and putting the rook on c1 so I could get it to c7. But Goryashkina went for rook to d1.
A little weird, actually. I mean, because I think we always were talking about this rook c1 idea. I was going to say, oh, she played bishop e3. That was what you wanted, Jovi, right? So,
yeah.
But the rook on d1 is it's not... The thing that it does, frankly, is it makes the rook on h1's job less meaningful, because I think in many ways you wanted both rooks to kind of be peering down at those open files. So... maybe that was the inaccuracy, rook d1 check, because the king was not comfortable there. So pushing it away maybe wasn't it.
Yeah. I must admit, I was obsessed with putting the rook on c1, getting it to c7, even if it meant getting into an opposite color bishop with rook's endgame. But now here, bishop to g4 looks like a very good move.
Yeah. The only thing that's weird about that for me, just in conceptually, is, yeah, the bishop is blocked on f5, but the rook on d1 wasn't impressive. Are you pushing it to a square where it's more impactful? Was there no other useful move you could make besides pushing the bishop to a better square? Mm-hmm. I don't know the answer to that, but I'm surprised that bishop g4 is the best you could do in that position.
Yes. Yes, you're right. You're absolutely right. Because if rook c1, what I was basing it on, I thought this bishop would just come out to b4. But I forgot the whole concept is to go bishop to d2. That is the plan, right?
And yeah, that's what we thought. Bishop,
king takes, and now we are going to go for knight to b6, put the rook on c7, the king will move over to e3. This bishop on g4, still a bad piece.
Yeah, so I don't know. They might just be killing it right now, and all these moves are what should be done. It's very, very interesting. Interesting choice, and let's not forget. It feels absurd to even consider Black has would have any chances given how the game has gone. Clockwise and position wise and prep wise, but Black is a pawn up and has the bishop pair. If for some reason this initiative is extinguished, you can see Anna turn the tables in all the ways that you can with the long term trumps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And just to dive deep into some moves, the rook comes to c1. That is the most natural move. What do we anticipate Anna playing?
I think I would go bishop b4 check. It feels like I want to trade more pieces. I want to negate the dark square grip. I need to find a way to get my rook on h8 into the game. That's the first start. This might be totally ridiculous, but I was even wondering if after, you know, you were saying bishop d2 and then trading the bishops, I was wondering, how insane is it to and try to go king d7 and insist on putting the rook there? But I see knight b6 check is an issue. D6. So, but maybe you can start with b6. I was even thinking b6 to cut out the knight on a4 and then go king d7. I mean, this looks ridiculous, and I see the bar went up, and it's probably too slow. But it's just trying to get the rooks connected, essentially.
Yeah, that's the big issue in this position, because one thing that I was looking at is putting the king on e3 and then going h3, g4, driving that bishop back, and then the rook can come to d1.
And then you kill me. you come in quick.
Yep. That is the plan. I'm not going to hide that one. Yeah, so... Okay, but maybe bishop... Maybe it makes no sense to go bishop to b4. I mean, after all, black's trump is the bishop pair. Can you...
how do you free yourself? I mean...
That is the question. And it's not one I have a comfortable answer to, but maybe if I go bishop to e7...
And then, I mean, what about your plan of like kicking the bishop? And I mean, still trying to kick the bishop, like
all the way.
Yeah, and then king e2.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not liking this position, but sometimes one makes a mistake in life, and you just have to live with the consequences. So. And if I go b5, try to drive you back, where are you jumping in with the knights?
Oh, you know where we're jumping in. But this was your dream, right? This is the bishop on g6 is dead, and the rook still.
Okay. In that case, what happens if I go? Ugh, this is disgusting, but maybe f5. I don't know whether to go f6 or f5.
I actually like that. The king is free. We've been trying to make it free. And you actually stop h3, g4 at least.
Yeah.
So the bishop remains on a diagonal, which controls the d1 square.
Mm-hmm.
So the rook on h1 can't get over. So maybe that's the way. But it's hard decisions to make with 11 minutes left and counting.
Oh, this very tense situation there for Anna Muzychuk. Not much time on the clock, and she has to tread a very narrow path to equality. I think on that note, it's a perfect time for us to take a short break, but don't go anywhere, because in a few minutes, we are going to catch up with all of the actions. You really don't want to be missing this one.
This is chess. Chess is an experience. The excitement. The joy. The devastation. The undeniable drive to play again and again. Chess is an experience that's meant to be shared. What if you could experience chess in a completely new way? On a real chessboard, with the power of AI at your fingertips. This is ChessUp 2. Take everything you love about playing on Chess.com and experience it on a real chessboard. Play a blitz match against a random online opponent. Conquer the bot you've been stuck on for months. Or challenge a friend halfway across the world. ChessUp 2 is always ready and always connected with built-in Wi-Fi. Never miss a move with full piece recognition. And review all your games right on chess.com. ChessUp 2 is more than a chessboard. It's a chess trainer. If you're new to chess, ChessUp will teach you. If you already know how to play, ChessUp will teach you how to really play. With patented AI assistance, you can balance a match between players of any skill level, or hone your skills against one of the built-in AI coaches. The makers of ChessUp 2 are the same team behind the original ChessUp, the best-selling smart chessboard in the world. So whether you're a beginner who wants to learn and improve while you play, or a chess pro who wants to go deeper into the world of chess, experience ChessUp 2 and level up your game.
And we are back with round two of the women's candidates. So far, it's been a pretty explosive round, but in different ways. We've seen a very fiery queen and pawn endgame. We've also seen tension in the game between Tan Zhongyi and Vaishali, and so much drama. So, Castle, what have you been feeling about today's games? Were you expecting this type of action after what appeared to be quite a slow start?
Yeah, I mean, there's just a lot of tension building, and I think, you know, the time management has been a little bit better in most of the games today, but the tension is off the chain. Nothing is clear. It's no one is losing, but everyone's kind of uncomfortable in some way, and we have every game, one side has a real, you know, homework assignment on their hands to solve. So you could take us wherever you want us to go, and we're going to find something really interesting to work with.
I think let's go to one game we haven't looked at for a while, Salimova, Leighton Jay. This one, to me, looks like it's just comfortable equality. Whilst the other three games, there's something on edge. Here, I think it's going to be a draw. I don't see how either side can play for more.
So we want to look at that one for a second and get it out of the way.
Yeah, just to get it out of the way. Okay. And then let's dive in to one game, which I'm dying to look at, is between Tan Zhongyi and Vaishali, because g4 has been played.
Okay. All right.
So let's go there.
So we're going to check out Salimova really quickly. Just to check in there. Definitely had been some exchanges. It was a symmetrical position for a long time from this queen's gambit accepted. And now the A and B pawns are still on the board, but that's about it. Once those pawns get vacuum off, the 4-on-4 on the same side is basically a very draw's position. And the fact that white's pawns are split doesn't change that story too much, right?
No. If black starts attacking the B pawn, well, white can do exactly the same against the A pawn. And like you said, 4 versus 4, it's going to be a comfortable draw.
Cool.
So let's get that one out of the way, and let's move on to my personal favorite, which is the Tan Zhongyi Vaishali game. Because like I said, white has just played g2, g4, taking the space on the king side. And there's no other word for it, but Vaishali is groveling hard here.
Yeah, I think, you know, we've spoken about the merits of the tug of war and the Carlsbad structure here for a minute. And essentially, Vaishali's been in a passive state and has now been organizing her forces to try and ready herself for these impending breaks that may happen on the king side. It looks like the rooks are lined up on the e-file to maybe play e5 one day. But even that is hard to accomplish because the d5 pawn is a target. You see that knight on f4 bearing down on it. And so that's a real issue. But I could see Vaishali maybe considering something like queen d6 and then trying to play e5. But it seems like a very, very risky decision to break in that way.
And there's an immediate threat on the board of knight takes d5, because there is pressure against this rook on e7. So his queen has to start protecting on d5. So you said queen to d6. That could be a move. And now I'm like just dreaming about what to do. Do I go g5, you know, to go g6? Do I go knight h5 to go queen to g5? Threaten checkmate.
Wow. Knight h5. Completely eluded me because I was looking at playing like g5 first in different positions, but knight h5 is really annoying. Actually, queen knight h5 queen g5 is curtains, because knight f6 check is also a fork as well, so you can't even you can't allow the queen to g5.
No, you can't allow the queen to g5, so therefore you have to either go h6. No, but h6 is going to invite g5, so don't want to be doing that.
What are you
doing?
And if
you go f6?
Can I go g5 anyway?
Yes.
Because now if you take or move the f-pawn, the e-pawn is really backward. And then I'd still have the knight f6 check stuff in the cards. So if you take on g5, if f takes g5, queen takes g5, I still have knight f6 in the cards. You could argue that white has split their pawns too, like the f3 pawn and the h3 pawn are split.
Can I show you this lovely tactic?
Yeah, show me. What is it? Oh, look at that. Chat, would you look at that?
See? Puzzle Rush every day helps, I tell you, Casa.
Yeah, I need to open my eyes sometimes, because, you know, that was not on my radar.
Well, it wasn't King H8. Wasn't that the best move? What were you thinking? I forced.
I mean, I don't know. I thought there'd be like a Rook F8 or Rook F7, yeah, but
Rook
both seemed very.
No. Actually, Rook F8 can't work because Rook takes E6 is the problem.
Still, again, yes. Puzzle Rush. You know,
you have to go Rook F7.
Yeah, and then I was the point was to actually play F4 and to clamp on this E6 pawn. And so the point is that white's pawns are split, no doubt about it, on the king side. But e6 is a backward pawn, and you can even see those rooks that are on the e-file now consider even shifting over to the g-file at the right moment and just put tremendous pressure on the pawn on g7. So just unpleasant. Again, the bar is saying it's still holdable. And I'm just telling you, this is a torture. Really tough position to deal with.
Totally. And I can see a few moves being played. Queen to d6. Yup. Whoa. We are getting our prediction game spot on. Knight to h5. It's a big threat on the board of queen to g5. Now, is Vaishali now on only move territories? Because we were looking at f6. h6 just looked horrible.
Yeah, and she also has 8 minutes left for 11 moves. Like, this is, Vaishali was in extreme time trouble yesterday, and she had like 20 moves for like 10 minutes or something like that. And she was able to steer the game towards, simplified waters. And I wonder if that was part of Tan Zhongyi's strategy today to basically keep pieces on the board for a while, knowing what happened yesterday. Because she's executed thus far really brilliantly. I mean, I can't say it enough. It's been really good stuff thus far. But we'll see what happens.
Yeah, totally. And it's an interesting change of pace, actually, for Vaishali. Because yesterday's game, you mentioned it was very tense. But ultimately, she was okay, maybe a little bit worse or feeling the pressure. Here, it's been a game, a very strategical game, and she just went wrong immediately with knight to b3, leaving her knight out there on a limb. Her knight's now misplaced. They should be on the king's side, defending the king. And somehow, it feels like she just kind of got tricked. Maybe it's nerves here.
Let me ask you, if you could pick up those knights you're highlighting and put them anywhere, where would you put them?
Knight g6.
And what about the other one?
The other one can go on f4. No.
Because that was the other thing. Let's say you can't capture anything, right? Let's say you go knight g6 and my queen goes back to f2 or something. Even in that best case scenario where you pick up the knights and put them somewhere, it's really not easy to answer because so many of the business squares in White's king side are covered. In fact, if you just drew a rectangle between e1, h1, h5, e1 to h1 to h5 to e5, like that, every square is contained. And it's one of these things when you go forward and you encroach and you still control all of the squares, it's like a really, really impressive thing.
Yeah, g3 squares covered, as you mentioned, e3, absolutely everything covered. And this rook is such a lovely piece to go rook to g2 if need be. But for the time being, is this duo that is calling all the shots, because queen to g5 is in the air. f6 feels shaky and very provocative because it allows g5. But what happens if you curl up into a ball and you go king to h8?
Well, wasn't your queen g5 move annoying?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, but now f6. Okay, so, maybe not queen. Okay, queen g5 is early. I have a tactic. I think this might work. I'm not a tactician, so forgive me. But knight f6. Oh, it's not check. But knight f6, I think, might work, because I have this f6. Rook lift on e5, right? So you have to take
to deal with queen f6, takes,
and then rook e5.
Rook e5.
And then knight takes rook. Rook takes rook to bring the other one over. And what I was stalled out on, I wasn't sure about h6. I didn't know what to do with h6, which just slows me down.
If h6, you introduce a new piece into the attack.
Oh, the knight. Okay, so I was worried about queen h6 and then f6 and bringing the rook over. So I was like, I don't know yet, but after h6, I was looking at g5, but I don't know if that's good.
Maybe g5 is okay, but yeah.
This is beautiful. Look at that.
This is lovely.
But honestly, I don't even see the end here, because after knight f4 in that final position, this rook d7, then is my king running to f8 or something, or my queen coming to f8? I don't see it.
Yeah.
The eval bar is showing us, but this is still not trivial. I'll say it like that. Looks like it's almost hitting home though.
Yes. How to continue this? This one's not so easy, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway,
okay. I was very excited there. Okay, so knight to f4.
Let's actually get back to the
build game. It. Okay, yeah.
Because I think some moves happened.
So yeah, indeed. After f6, played g5.
Aha! Look at that. And
now f5.
And this one.
Look at the evaluation bar.
There's a tactic. There's a tactic.
So knight f6 is the point number one.
Oh yes. Oh yes. Yeah, yeah. Knight f6 check. You have to take because it's a four and because it's mate. G takes f6. You can't move the rook to g7. So rook f7 is the only way. And then rook g2 check. The king has to go to h8. Because if king f8, queen h6, mate, and then knight f4. Knight g6 coming. But here's the kicker. It's actually kind of funny. Rook g8 is the only move, right? To defend knight g6 check. And after rook g8, you could just trade the rooks and then go king, and then move the king probably to h1 or f2. I think like h1 more. And then you have the same idea again.
That's beautiful. Okay, and if the king runs, you know, tries
you're
to...
Just, then my knight comes
oh,
to
no,
e6.
Oh no, knight takes... Yeah, but also this is hanging too. Oh, queen h6, rook takes e6, knight takes e6, everything is falling. Ooh.
Wow.
Let's just run through that one again. Okay, so knight f6, that's you have to take.
And Tan Zhongyi just moved. She just moved, and she played not knight f6, but rook g2, which does the same exact thing. It does the same exact thing. It's a move order dynamic that mm-hmm. does not change anything.
Oh, okay. So if the king moves over to h8, we're still coming in knight to f6.
Yeah, and if you're really reluctant to sack a piece like that, you could start with knight df4, which threatens a gorgeous discovery. So like if king h8, knight df4, then we're threatening knight g6 check and knight f6 mate.
Okay, we have to show that one. So if you make a random move, okay, let's just move my rook anywhere. Then we go knight to g6, pawn takes knight. Knight f6, checkmate.
Mm. You see my face?
Beautiful.
That's a stank face. That's a
That is going into the books. And we have a move. What has she played? King to h8.
All right. So there are a lot of fun options. And wow. The time advance, she has time to marinate here. Again, we've talked about knight df4 being elegant. Knight f6 right away. I think the human perspective, the human in me would go knight df4 just because it feels the safest. You don't have to calculate as much. And the problem is if you go e5 to try and break things up, then we can introduce the knight f4 move, knight f6 move again, because after knight f6, the mate threats are direct because now the knight is on f4. The knight g6 stuff is more devastating than before.
Yeah, knight g6 is checkmate is threatened. Wonderful. You can't go pawn takes knight because the queen takes h7 checkmate. No, it makes perfect sense. Why introduce a sacrifice when you don't need to? All it takes is just to get a new piece into the attack. Knight df4, threatening knight to g6. Check. We also have knight f6 in the back of the pocket. It's over. Tan Zhongyi, she is a fantastic tactical player. This is elementary for her.
Yeah, so it's funny, you get the winning position sometimes and you know that it's winning, or I mean, she's known that this has been promising for a while, and now she knows she's like I'm a few moves away potentially. And it's so easy to rush. And it takes real maturity and discipline to say, you know what, even though I'm up 40 minutes on the clock and I've been putting pressure for basically the second half of this game, I'm still gonna, you know, be measured in my approach to finishing because I don't want to let anything slip. And it's also sometimes just to relax yourself, even if you've seen the line, it's just to kind of relax the mind, the body before you execute. So a good lesson for folks out there, again, to not necessarily play on someone's time in a rushing way. And we actually saw the same thing yesterday with Humpy, who was also playing Vaishali. She had a massive advantage time-wise, like 20, 30 minutes. And at the right before the time control, it actually evened out. And you could say, well, that was maybe sloppy or whatever, but it was also mature to be like, I'm going to not rush these decisions.
Yeah. No, it's good to take your time. She has 47 minutes on the clock. No need to rush this one and make an impetuous move. Instead, she can just work out the complications. And she's fantastic at calculating. Let's not forget that Tan Zhongyi was women's world champion in 2017. And she narrowly lost that title to Ju Wenjun in 2018. And since then, she has been a formidable competitor. She's in the world's top five players. She's not someone to be underestimated. And if she wins, that will be a fantastic start. 2 points out of two, winning with the black pieces against Lei Ting Jie, and now with a superb position against Vaishali.
So we've been singing Tan Zhongyi's praises for a minute. So often, at this level, folks converted it really well. But I know that if I was playing a blitz game or even, you know, a 10-minute game, I might try to still keep it going for a little while. And I know if it was a bullet game, we'd all keep it going. But if it was a blitz game, we might try. What would be the best try to keep it going to not get mated here if we're black? Would it be giving up an exchange with G6? Would it be...
Well, it's white to play, unfortunately. So, brother.
I mean, oh, brother. I forgot about that. Oh, no.
Yeah. So the problem is, you know, you might have to give up your queen to keep the game alive.
Oh. All right.
The only chance there is to flag someone, and that's not happening.
Yeah. So Tan Zhongyi is still thinking. I think she might make a move pretty soon. And she's staring in that vicinity. Up, the hand's coming up. Nope. Hand in the head. So you know, sometimes you bring the hand, you're like almost right, and then you're like, no, let me do this instead. it's like a grab. And you know, I must say, as someone that plays against someone that might be about to move and then doesn't, and then they're about to and then doesn't, it's so annoying because you're like, just move already.
I once saw that in action, actually, in a tournament. So one person had 10 seconds left and there was no increment whatsoever. The other one had, and I kid you not, 50 minutes. So there was a poor person with 10 seconds, you know, with his hand over the piece, whilst the one on 50 minutes was just like leaning back, looking around, you know, taking 10 minutes, and we're going to have a move. And here it is, knight to d4 played, introducing a new piece into the attack, deadly threat of knight g6 about to be played.
Yeah, and it's basically out of the frying pan into the fire. That was what the king h8 move did. It got it a one check, and now it's about to get hit with another check. And less than 4 minutes, I don't think we're going to actually get to time control here, frankly, because there's just too much. There's just trouble in paradise. Knight f6, the combination of knight f6 and knight g6 is vicious. And can we actually just show a little cute mate? Let's say e5. Let's just say, I know it's not a great move. And then let's say knight f6. And then let's say h6, defending the mate.
Ooh, what but we got you're not, because you slide the knight into g6, and that's a double knight checkmate to the king. Actually, when you see this pattern, a knight on f6 and a king diagonally across it, then you just know you need another knight to give a check, and it will be checkmate.
It's art. It's art. I've never had the pleasure of executing it in a real game, in a over the board game. I've had it in Blitz before, but it just is a beautiful, beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Oh, knight df4. How to keep the game alive? And I think she's gone for your e5.
And here we are. That's the move. Now, there. You have to go for the tactics now. That was the one thing about committing the knight to f4 is now the position, if you just relax for a moment, like if you play something like d takes at e5, then you bring the knight back into the game. So knight f6 is a must, and it's played. Played.
It was not the time to back down. It was a time to go in for the kill. And there it comes. Knight f6 on the board, gf6, and quick knight to g6 check.
And we didn't actually talk about this, but the problem here is this king is not going to be able to run beyond the e-file. It might not even get there because the king is going to go to g7 or g8. It's not so relevant where. And then knight takes e7 will happen. And then, and then g takes f6 happen. And we have a resignation.
Yes, so Tang Zhongyi gets off to a blistering start. 2 points out of two. Very convincing win against the talented Vaishali. Oh, what a game. What a performance. So, this game has finished. Now let's cast our eyes on to some of the other games in
really
progress.
Really quickly, can we just show the finish there for folks at home that might not understand why the resignation was there, just to show what happens next. If the king goes to g7, let's say, or g8, mm-hmm. there'll be knight takes g7. Sorry, not g7. Knight takes e7, rook or queen takes, rook or whatever, and then g takes f6 check. And admittedly, the king on g7 is worse than it would be on g8. But either way, there was going to be a discovery check, which would also net the rook. And frankly, a blistering attack still with the queen on h4. So Black was shedding heavy material. It was the right decision for Vaishali to move on and fight, look for better days. And brilliant game by Tan Zhongyi.
Absolutely brilliant. But let's cast our eyes on to the other games, and let's take a look at Salimova against Lei Tingjie. Once we last visited this, we thought that this was going to be a very quick draw. And looking at the game position, it certainly looks like the players are headed in that direction. G6 attacking the rook played. All Salimova needs to do is just move the rook anywhere, really.
Yeah, and it's a 3-on-3 on the same side. A slight structural deficiency, but it doesn't change the details so much. In fact, if one of White's pawns was gone, let's say like the e3 pawn, it'd still objectively be a draw with 3-on-2 on the same side. So 3-on-3 is surely a similar thing. And the only thing White really should avoid is allowing the black pawn to get all the way to h3. So king g2 is a good job not to allow that. White will ultimately play h3, h4 in the next few moves if it's not a blunder. And that'll probably simplify things. And we're close to move 40. So I believe draw offers are on the cards, at least beyond move 40.
Yeah, you're not allowed to offer a draw until past move 40. But you are allowed to repeat the position three times. Perhaps this could be the start of a repetition. If the king moves over to f1 or anywhere, this rook can just move back to where it came from. And the players can make the draw in that way.
Yeah, that's the way where you make a move and they repeat once, and then you both look at each other like, are we going here? We're gonna take this walk in the park really quickly, and then there's that little mutual acknowledgement. So we're seeing that on the board with king f1. The rook was last on. It was it before? It was on a4. So
a4.
So the rook a4. Oh no, rook h4. Because I'm a little a different type of dance.
Maybe this is more accurate because after rook h4, she goes king to g2, and yes, the dance is in progress. Rook to g4 check, and this is the point where the players are going to make that eye contact.
And if we learned yesterday how to, for folks at home, you do not, when you're claiming the repetition, you do not do it by saying draw or by making the move. And then what you do is you write the move down on your score sheet. Then you call the arbiter and then you show that it would be a three move repetition. I've never done it before. Again, I've played many tournaments in my life. I've never claimed a draw like that, but it is something that's a good to know.
That is the correct way to offer or claim the threefold draw repetition. And there you see it. There we see a draw between Salimova and Leighton Jay, which means that Leighton Jay now gets off the scoreboard and Salimova moves to 1 point. So two games finished. Tang Zhongyi getting off to a dream start with two victories, first against Leighton Jay and then secondly against Vaishali with white pieces today. But let's take a look at the other two games remaining in progress. Where should we go?
I feel like this queen end game, I have a little bit of a curiosity there just because it's transformed a great deal. Because this is different, and I don't know the pawn. Some pawns got traded. I'm curious to see what happened here from when we last looked at it, right? Because we looked at it with Queen C6, right?
We looked at it with Queen C6, and we were contemplating like how can White make progress. White does have the outside pass pawn. This is very valuable in an endgame, and the game progressed with White playing G3. Queen came to c3. Beautiful move there from Humpy, completely keeping this pawn under lock and key, and at the same time mobilizing the queen to her best. So queen c3, queen to g4, king f8, queen f5, and queen c1 check, king g2, queen c6, queen f3, and that's how I was going to say that. That's how the a4 pawn came off the board, but it didn't come off the board like that. It came off the board at this particular point.
Clever. So I think the little wrinkle there with why Humpy didn't take the pawn off right away is she wanted to not allow h4 to come as smoothly. And by basically that little repetition that happened, in order for Lakhno to make progress, she actually had to play king h3, which gets in the way of that advance. And so that was a annoying little wrinkle that basically makes it a much harder to try and get something here. That was a clever wrinkle. It's interesting that she played queen takes f6. My instinct would be to take the h pawn, but that's why I'm not 25-50. Mm-hmm. Because to me, the h-pawn was a more valuable pawn. But I guess you can say, okay, I'm going to get queen h8 check next. And that's the smarter way to kind of vacuum. But I don't know.
This does allow the queen to centralize, though. And I thought maybe the plan was to come up with the king to h4. Maybe try to snake the way into h6 at the right time. But we have a response, g4. Yeah, I've done it before myself in a queen and pawn endgame. So g4 played.
All right, this is tricky because your snaking idea is actually really cool. Like that really is, that's an idea. And also, right, queen h8 is still a threat. And we got to show this. So if your snaking idea, if king g8 just to defend against queen h8 threat, well, what about this? We have this Sherman's March dynamic. That's why I call it a Civil War reference. You also call it Nigel Short had a famous game with king h4, king g5, king h6 to deliver this checkmate. And all of a sudden, the king h5, king h6 is a massive threat. So if you make a few passing moves, let's say you play c6 with the pawn.
Maybe you go c5.
I wanted to go c6 and then c5 just to show one thing really quickly.
Okay.
So if you go, if you go c6 and then king h5 and then c5 and then king h6, I'm just saying it's not the best, but I'm just saying queen takes g4, queen d8 is mate. I get that there's a pawn endgame that's winning with queen e6 there. I just wanted to illustrate that this mate is a massive danger to deal with. And that's no joke. So
no, it's certainly not a joke. No, it really, you're completely right. It's not a joke because the idea is there and you use all your pawns to shelter the king.
Yeah. Now, actually, I think one thing we have to be a little careful of is if you go f4, maybe there's some queen to f3 business, the black queen getting in, like maybe like something like, this is so dangerous.
But, totally dangerous. So, and you can't let go of, you can't go queen e6 because queen takes d4 is happening. And if you go c5, at the very least, you also have queen to g5. Check.
Oh, that's even better.
C5, you pick up the c5 pawn and you still have your idea of getting your king all the way around to h6.
So how does black deal with this? Because if you stand still, we're basically showing these lines where if black stands still, it's a wrap. So black has to find some very active way, probably to tickle the white king, to harass the white king. I mean, that's a tough task. So very interesting play, this g4 move. Wow. And for the record, we're still analyzing here, so we're not at the live position. King h4 has not been played, neither is king g8, but it's still, king g8 is such a natural move to just cover the pawn, and it would seem that that just makes the position worse. So black has to try and get on the attack. So if we go back a move or two, maybe
okay,
there's
so this
some...
is the game position, g4.
You gotta be, oh, what about, no, h5, that doesn't work because queen h8 check is again hitting the h5 pawn.
Okay, in queen and pawn endings, you have to go active with the queen.
Okay, so how are you going active?
So there's one golden rule in queen and pawn endings is that you've got to centralize your queen. So let's centralize it with queen to d5.
Annoying, I love that.
And then
now
queen
you have
to f3.
So now if I get active trying to take the h7 pawn, it's not going to work because you're going to take on f2 with check and have a lot to say about that. So
yeah, so if you do this, queen takes h7, queen to f3, and maybe there's even a turnaround because now you've literally won a pawn that didn't count.
Yeah, just taking on f2 and then... yeah, there's just going to be way too much activity, and the white king is not going to feel so secure. So that's not it. So white can't actually take on h7 after queen d5, and then it's like, how do you improve after queen d5? I don't know. I think maybe I'm compelled to just not prepare the queen h8 check. So maybe like king g3 to not allow that. And I think I have to point this out. White, black is an extra pawn on the queen side, or in the center, really, with the c pawn. So but it's actually backward. So because it's backward, it's gonna have there's a feature in many of these pawn end games where the queen trades will actually just be dead loss for black, because white has a 3-on-2 on one side, and then on the king side, and then if the white king moseys in to e4. And then d5 before the pawn break c4 happens, it's actually a very different story. So the one dangerous thing here is normally even material with pawns, you think, oh, the queen trades are going to be fine, and they're not necessarily the case.
No, I agree with you. Also, I just want to say that when it comes to the king and pawn ending, white has the possibility to generate a potential pass pawn on the king side, and will be an outside pass pawn, which is better. to have, because it means that the black king will be decoyed. But we have a move, and it looked like Humpy was an only move territory. What has she played? No, she's found queen to d5.
She's proven to be a great defender so far. I mean, yesterday she was very precise throughout the game, and today she's gotten every sort of task or question she's answered very adequately. So it's funny because most people I would say, nah, they're not gonna hold this together. No, I don't care what the engine says. And with Humpy, it's like it's more likely than not she does, and it's just a representation of her class.
Totally. But now she's going to have to show her class, because there's a big threat of queen to h8, picking up the h7 pawn, getting ready to advance the h pawn. So how does black get counterplay? King to g8, we didn't like it before. Maybe we don't like it. Mm. Hang on a second. Isn't ideas like h4, h5, h6?
You know what's crazy? After h4... And I'm not sure about this, but I'm thinking maybe even queen g5 check, trading the queens might be a winning pawn ending.
Yes.
I don't know for sure. Like, if c6 is played, let's say, I'm not 100% sure, admittedly, because they are doubled pawns and it's a little bit trickier. And maybe the black king can run towards the center. But it feels very shaky because... if the king can get to e5 before the black king gets to d6, then the pawns will drop.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely right. No, I think queen to g5 is a winning endgame for white.
So weird.
Like you say, the king is going to be so fast in moving over to e4, and the pawn on g5 can't adequately be defended by a pawn on f4. Oh, Humpy might be in trouble. So again, she has to tread very carefully. So after queen to d5, king to d3, and she has to find the correct path to equality. It's not going to be easy, but we are going to take a short break, and when we return, we'll come back with more of the action. So don't go anywhere.
Has this ever happened to you?
Oh, shoot. Another mouse slip.
What about this?
Oh, well, holy bishops en passant. I think I'm getting carpal tunnel.
If only there was a way to play online chess with a real-life board.
What if I told you? You can, with ChessUp 2. That's right. With ChessUp 2, you can now play over the board online.
Wow.
Simply connect your Chess.com account to our state-of-the-art ChessUp 2 and get a game started. Every time you move, our revolutionary board will transmit the data online directly to your opponent. And as soon as they move, squares will light up, signifying which piece is going where.
Well, shucks, this Hikaru guy seems pretty good.
With ChessUp 2, mouse slips and sore wrists are a thing of the past.
My carpal tunnel is gone. Well, this sure is fun. I'm playing online against my new friend, Hikaru. Who needs a family? But I sure do miss clicking on a piece and seeing all of my available moves, like they have on chess.com.
Well, Danny, you're in luck. This feature is totally available on the ChessUp 2 as well.
Wow. Well, I'm convinced. But hey, what if I don't just want to play an opponent online? What if I want to use one of chess.com's other great tools?
I thought you'd never ask. With ChessUp 2, you can fully take advantage of the chess.com integration by playing bots, analyzing your offline games, and even using our optional AI assistance to visualize the quality of moves with color-coded hints.
Well, holy f***, ChessUp, you did it. You made IRL chess cool again.
You got it, Danny.
And how do you know my name?
Play chess today on the board of tomorrow.
If Vaishali were to win the candidates and then the world championship, she would be India's first women's champion. First, she has to win the candidates. Like her younger brother Pragnananda, who is also competing in Toronto, Vaishali is rising fast in the chess world. She entered the Grand Swiss in October, seeded number 12 out of 50. But with some brilliant play and an undefeated 6 wins out of 11, she climbed all the way to the top. The win put her into the candidates. Here, she is one of just 2 players who has never played for a world championship. Will that relative lack of experience be an issue? Or will Vaishali be as equally unfazed as the player who won the Grand Swiss? We will find out. Whatever happens, Vaishali's future is bright. History, prestige, legacy. Words synonymous with the most coveted title in chess. To be a world champion means your name etched in the history books alongside greats of the past.
Ding Li Ren, a deserving world champion.
Ding is overtaken by emotions. What a match this has been.
But for 8 men and 8 women, it's here and it's now. As the road to the world championship goes through Toronto, Canada. Over 3 weeks, chess's elite compete for their right to challenge for the crown. For some, it's a story of redemption.
He knows this might be the last few moves of his world championship.
Oh my God.
There's experience, there's youth, and for one nation on the rise, fortune could favor indeed.
An amazing day for Indian chess, making their way into the candidates tournament.
Only one will advance. Only one will play for it all. Watch the 2024 FIDE candidates on chess.com.
Welcome back to round 2 of the women's candidates, and what a round it's been so far. We've already seen one decisive game, Tan Zhongyi convincingly defeating Tan Zhongzhi. And then we also saw a hard-fought draw being played between Salimova and Lei Tingjie. But 2 games remaining, and we left them at stage critical. So, Kaza, shall we bring up the bird's eye view and have a look at what's happening?
Yeah, so we got 2 games left. Humpy versus Lucknow. It seemed like Lucknow is really pressing with white. So I feel like we ought to go there because we were talking about just the dangers in that ending. It's a queen. It's a queen pawn endgame with even pawns, but given the nature of white's more active king and some sort of threats connected to queen h8 check, it's a lot trickier than it meets the eye. And we're also noting that a lot of the queen trades that could happen result in winning pawn endgames for white because white's king is closer to the center and black's extra pawn, that c pawn, is backward. So very, very tricky dynamic. The clock times are also not super high, but not super low either. So we've got about 9 moves for 10 minutes.
Yeah. So we left it at this particular position, and we were saying that after king to g8, black would probably be in a lot of trouble after h4 on account of queen to g5, trading off the queens. And so Humpy says, you know what? I'm not going to defend this h7 pawn and instead go on the counterattack with c5. Now there's a threat of c4. And you know what we say about pass pawns? It's the quality, not the quantity. And this looks a bit scary, actually, for Lucknow. Maybe she'll have to bail out.
You know what's something? Humpy is so good. Like, I mean, really, to have that recognition is really impressive. But then, to be honest, I would still go for queen h8, check, and then take h7, because I'm a pawn up, and I feel like I can always get a perpetual check against the black king with it being so exposed. And even the white king is not that far away from the d-pawn. Like, it's in the square. So I feel like I would go for queen h8 check and take the pawn. I see that c4 is coming, but it still feels like Humpy has more work to do.
Okay. It certainly does have to be played. And here, presumably, I would just take queen takes and then bring check. The king. Yeah, give it, of course, centralize the queen.
Because it's a pin too. It's so it prevents the black, the white, the black pawn on d4 from moving. And it just feels like, is this really just equal still? Like, is it, this is what the bar is showing?
Yeah, it's the quality. This d pawn is worth 5 pawns on the second rank. Well, maybe not that much, but okay, we have a move. So queen, not queen to h8, but instead h4. So I'm expecting c4 from Humpy. Her goal is simply just to generate a passed pawn.
The clever thing about h4 is that now there are some mating tricks, right? So we're talking about c4 constantly and d takes c4. If a pawn gets to h6, queen d8 is checkmate. So if we kind of willy-nilly just allow, push shove the d-pawn after the d3 pawn is traded, black would get mated. So if we went like h, let's say c4, just for argument's sake, d takes c4, queen takes c4, h5, d3, h6, d2. Again, the bars jumping around, we're just illustrating queen d8 would be mate. And that's kind of the concern here. But this is basically the last task that Humpy needs to solve. And I think this action one is a little bit easier than the questions that was posed to her a few moves ago, which she also handled brilliantly.
She handled that one brilliantly. And also to fight the instinct just to be materialist and go king to g8 to play queen to d5, I think c4 has to be played. Otherwise, you're not following the plans of the position, which is you got to get counterplay. You got to start trying to advance the d-pawn. So c4, I think, is a must. And after queen takes c4, if you carry on with your idea of going h5, well, maybe still we tricky. Can... It is tricky, but what happens if I just go queen to d5? Anyhow?
I wanted to go h6, but is that too... That's just too foolhardy? Yeah, looks like it. Looks like it. I was wondering if I could get away with taking on h7 and then having an h-pawn myself, but just a little bit too slow. Yeah, too slow.
Yeah. In that case, after dc4, h5, queen to d5, I mean, is there any way that white can bail out?
So given what happened, that this h6 stuff doesn't work, the bailout would just be not even playing h5. It would be queen d8 check, queen g5 check, and just perpetuating like that, right? Repeating mm-hmm. like that. So instead of even playing h5, just to go check, 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 done. And you sit and you, after queen takes c4, and you say, you know what? The stuff doesn't work. I've had enough of this. The d pawn has been dangerous. Humpy, you did a great job defending, and I'm on to the next.
Was c4 played? And I just had a thought just here on the analysis while I've got it up. I was thinking after queen to d8 check, king to g7, maybe you can throw in h5 with the idea of going h6.
Ooh, we got to show that. We got to show that. If d3 is played, you got to finish that one. Oh, h6. My goodness. Check. That is art.
No. I didn't have an answer to king to g6, but my big idea was that after king takes h6, the queen will come to f6, and that will be checkmate.
Take a bow. That is art. That is exquisite. And I think you would find, if you looked at that other line just like for an additional 10 seconds after king g6, I think you'd find things you'd like after king g6 as well. So if like mm-hmm. h6 check, king g, in that line you were just looking at with king g6, yeah. There are a few fun ways Yeah, f4 looks really, because there are no checks. The king on g3 is safe for the moment. So I actually thought there was this cool looking way with queen h8, which was like threatening mate in one. But you, again, you still can't take the h6 pawn, right? So it's queen g7 is mate.
Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Well, there's a tiny bit of danger, but of course, h5 can simply be met with black responding with h6. So unlikely we're going to see this on the board. But here, after h4, c4 played by Humpy, d takes c4, queen takes c4. And it's decision time for Katarina. Does she just want to end the game right now? Put the queen on d8 and check on d8 and g5. That would be a perpetual check. Or does she want to throw in some final tricks?
So wait, what was the defense against h5 though?
So we played d3. King to g7 and h5. I was thinking you just go h6.
Okay, all right. Fiscally responsible. Just, I mean, because here I'm even wondering if g5, I keep the threats going, right? Like, it's, I'm still, yeah. You still got to prove
something.
But I have
something. Some checks. I've got my checks.
That's just one. I just go f3 and I was one. One and done. Like these college players. College basketball these days, one and done. No more checks.
Yes, that's true. But you don't have any threats either, do you?
I have queen f6, check, and g6. Okay, you're taking. All right, so you said I didn't have any threats. I had a threat. You ruined my my hopes and dreams. if you went, I thought if you went like queen d2, I thought I might have.
Yeah, then queen f6 check.
But even here, the bar is laughing. I thought that there was something with the g takes h6, and you know.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. Ah, queen e1 check.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we tried. We tried. But alas, Humpy's defenses are. What did you call it? Much earlier in the broadcast, where you were saying when you kind of like hold the fort and you kind of defend really staunchly and like, and what was it called? You said the Scottish folks.
The Gandalf.
Gandalf. This
approach.
Is, you shall not pass. Yeah, this is that. This is basically totally emblematic of that, right?
Okay. And in the meantime, we have a few moves. Queen d8 played, king to g7, queen to g5, king f8. What is going to happen next?
Are they staring?
Some fantastic defense by Humpy there. Ridiculous. And I know knight to d4 earlier on, if we were to go all the way back, it was a risky shot. And Katarina had the chance to consolidate that potential extra pawn with c4. But other than that, that was the only slight mistake that Humpy made. She hasn't put a foot wrong. The queen ending has been exceptional from her end.
Yeah, I mean, totally. Except I wonder what she would have done. Maybe there'll be, we might get maybe some type of interview or something later, because I would love to figure out later what she intended if c4 was played. And maybe she just was going to argue, well, I take on b3, I would have taken okay, well, they're repeating now, but maybe she would have snapped the bishop off on b3 and just said, I have obstacle at bishop position, pawn down, I can defend that too. But yeah, there, here we go. We've repeated once or almost one and a half. That's the other thing, Jovi. I never know how many times it is. This is why I never claim, because I never know how many. I never do the counting right. Counting to three is evidently hard for me. So I've never done it this like this. I'm just don't want to get it wrong, you know. So I'm like, whatever. Like, it's cost me a few games. Honestly, there are games I could have claimed against very strong players where I didn't, because I didn't know what I was doing. but I usually don't accept draws much anyway, or offered them. So
queen to g5 played, and now I think this is king f8. And now if she goes queen to d8, yeah, this is the moment where after king to g7, they have repeated three times. And there we see the handshake. And a very well fought queen and pawn ending, a draw in the end for Katarina Lagner and Humpy Canary. But it did have us by the tenterhooks at times. What a game. What a round it's been.
Yeah, I had really, really impressive defense. And we are down to our last game. If I'm not mistaken here, we got three results in the bag and this tense game. Oh, Muzychuk has 15 seconds left.
15 seconds.
Hold on. Whoa. Whoa.
And move 27 as well.
And the game is totally changed. We're maybe going to just let this breathe instead of going back, given that the time situation is what it is. But somehow the rooks got into the game, and this knight, this is the champion of the position right now, is on c8. It's killing it. This winning line is beautiful.
I think she's just made a mistake as well. I think she can take the bishop on e7. She put her rook on d8, and there is a pin. If she captures with king takes knight, she can just simply... And there it is on the board. Knight takes bishop. Oh.
But I don't think there was anything you could do. It was pinned up anyway, because the e7 bishop was under fire. The d7 rook was unprotected, so there was no real way to reinforce the 7th rank. And I don't know if this one is going to make it to move 40 either, because there are 12 moves to go and an exchange is about to be secured. You can argue that bishop on d3 is actually a nice anchor, but it won't be enough.
No. And Anna is trying bishop c4, but after rook takes rook, is that not just an extra piece for Alexandra?
Well, Anna will maybe get two pawns for it if bishop takes it, a2 happens. Still, with the class at this level, it shouldn't be close to enough, frankly. There might be a few more moves. But something happened that we missed. I don't know if we want to, while Goretzkin is thinking, just go very quickly back to somewhere in the mid-20s and figure out what actually happened, because we said this bishop was on d3 the last time we saw, and we were impressed that it got there and it was not compromised yet.
Yeah, okay, so let's quickly go to this particular position.
We have a move.
So let's go back.
All right, so rook takes e7, rook takes knight. Knight is under fire, it's gonna get away.
Can come back to c8, can go to
c6. Oh, c8. Oh my god, c8. That's the I was thinking c6, c8 is it's going to get on an outpost immediately. Knight d6.
Yeah.
That's lights out, actually. Knight come back to c8.
She's just an extra piece up.
Wow.
Yeah.
Tense game.
And yeah, the knight does move to c8. Knight to d6 is threatened. Bishop takes a2, as you mentioned.
Bags pawn number two, but at what cost? The real problem is that it's hard for the queenside pawn, or sorry, the kingside pawns to get rolling. If you could somehow get in f4, you might feel like there might be a whisker of a chance. But
well, there might even be a checkmating idea as well on the board. Knight d6, and if the king goes to e7, the rook can swing down to c8.
Yeah, king g6 is the only move to, and that's the problem, is you can't get this g5, f4 business going because the king is just caught. And okay, rook a1, of course, it just nets the a6 pawn right back. I was now looking at g4 trying to open things, but it's totally unnecessary. And again, the professional decision was played, rook a1 by Goretzkina. Mm-hmm. The practical problems that Anna was asked to solve were really, really brutal. And I think a resignation, she just stopped the clocks and there we go. We have a result.
We have certainly a result, and it is our second decisive game of the round. Alexandra Goretzkina winning this, springing an opening surprise on Anna Muzychuk and setting a lot of practical problems from the beginning to the end. Very impressive display there from Alexandra.
Yeah, I mean, just from the beginning, this Bishop in F5 struggled to find work. And yeah, it wound up doing her in at some point later in the game. And these are our results. We have them on the screen there, Jovi. Two decisive results, a little bit of a standing shakeup.
Certainly, and we've seen that one player is in red hot form, Tan Zhongyi, getting off to a wonderful start, winning both her games. Alexandra Gryashkina on 1.5 points, and then we have a whole load of people on 1 point, and there we see at the bottom, Anna Muzzi took Leiting Jay and Vaishali on 0.5 points. But still, we are only on round two. This is a marathon 14 round event. Plenty to play for. So who impressed you the most today?
I think my answer is going to be all too predictable. Tan Zhongyi has demonstrated two master classes in the Carlsbad structure. So don't play that against her, is my advice to her other competitors. Her maneuvering was flawless. The understanding of the vision was excellent. And perfect start.
Totally. And I must admit, you've managed to convince me, a staunch defender of the black side of that pawn structure, that things are not as easy as they appear. I really enjoyed actually Alexandra's game from the beginning, the way that she posed those problems to Anna Muzicic, forced her to burn that time on the clock. And I also really enjoyed the battle between Katarina Lagno and Humpy Canero. That one had us gripped from beginning to end. What a day of excitement it's been.
Yeah. And it's such a marathon event. There are 12 rounds to go. No one is really out of it, even though it might seem that way from an early result. So there's all the opportunity in front of every single player to get back in it and really still contend. So it's about keeping those nerves level and getting more comfortable with your settings and your environment at this point.
Yeah, it's the time, you know, to see what people are made of, how they deal with adversity and setback. But we are only in round two. Tomorrow it's going to be round three. So let's have a look at some of those exciting pairings. Anna Muzicic plays Katarina Lagno. Leiting Jay faces off against Alexandra Gryashkina. Vaishali gets Salimova. And Humpy Canero faces Tan Zhongyi, tournament leader. Which match excites you the most?
I want to see Humpy versus Tan Zhongyi, because Humpy's played really two impressive kind of solid games, and I wonder what her approach will be going up against Tan Zhongyi, who has been really amazing thus far. That's the one I'm going to look at.
Yeah, for me, I guess it would be Leiting Jay against Alexandra Gryashkina. I want to see how these two active players handle off against each other. But either way, the players are bringing it to the table in these two rounds, and I can't wait for more of the same action tomorrow. And I'd like to thank you, Kasa, because it's been absolutely amazing commentating alongside you. And I'd like to thank everyone for watching at home and joining in. It's been a lot of fun, a lot of excitement, and tomorrow we are going to have so much more of the same. Thank you all for watching, and see you tomorrow.